Hello everybody, and welcome to this, another episode of Mass Effect using the Genesis system. My name is Thomas, I'll be the GM today, and these are my amazing players. Say hello everybody.
Hello.
Hi.
And last time, where we left off, the squad made it to the elusive Site B on this mining colony planet, and when they got there, escaping the clutches of a giant, terrifying alien monster, they managed to arrive just in time for a frigate to try and burst through the static atmosphere of this planet and explode on entry, showering the Site B area with fragments of debris and nearly breaking some of the atmospheric dampeners, keeping the site safe as well. Fortunately, thanks to the quick work of Miles and his mechanical prowess, you managed to diagnose the major sort of hole within the dampener net system and quickly set to work using an exosuit to piece things back together as well. You also took the opportunity to examine the wreckage of the frigate once it stopped exploding and found some useful salvage in there, and also the information that you believe that these people were some kind of mercenary group, small time. They came here ready for a fight. Meanwhile, everybody else, except for Talora, unfortunately, who was slightly knocked dazed from the rapid driving maneuvers to avoid getting showered on by the debris of the falling frigate, you took her to get some medical attention, and in the process you met the administrative overseer of this particular site. It was a Krogan, very kind of old, battle-worn, melted side of his face, by the name of Kayrak Ogryn. And for the most part, when you informed him about the situation that was happening at the rest of the mining base, he seemed very jaded and effectively turned in his resignation. Unfortunately, when you all reunited, we saw that Ogryn and Miles had a little bit of a shared past. Miles took part in some wet work on T'Chunka and slightly destroyed Ogryn's clan and hopes for a bright future for the Krogan.
But I just burned down a field. It's not my fault they all ran into the middle of the thing.
And so after a very tense standoff between those two, the situation was diffused thanks to a lot of people, but sort of finished off by Kalor's sort of calming words that managed to, at the very least, stop Ogryn from immediately trying to tear this human's head off before all your eyes. In the process, you also talk to a Quarian by the name of Sadi Kotas Bantu, and you learnt that she has a brother by the name of Viaz who went missing into the mines shortly after the Prothean ruins were discovered within. And she told you, Kalor, that she was not responsible for sending all the data about the migrant fleet to exposing all that data. And unfortunately, that means that the only other Quarian on base is her brother Viaz, so naturally both you and her want to track him down and see what is going on there. So you all departed and went into the mine itself, and very quickly things were going a little bit strange. You heard cries, screams, voices in the darkness, and as you maneuvered around, eventually you came across these bizarre, semi-translucent humanoid beings that were interacting and moving around in this place, and you soon stumbled across what appeared to be a fragment of Viaz's memory being played out when he was being sort of disciplined as a child for as a young Aquarian for supremely messing up some of his mechanical duties. Your friend Erda almost also got confronted by some sinister ghostly figures as well. Ultimately, you're reunited and continued pushing into the base, searching both for the missing Viaz and also for any particularly lucrative technology you might be stumbling across in this Prothean ruin, as there currently is a massive bounty that is no doubt drawing many to this location, but you have first dibs, as it were. So, where we left off, everybody just entered the massive bore hole that was created in this large metallic wall that was effectively the exterior of this Prothean ruin. And you stepped inside, you noted that the design and architecture was a little bit unusual based on what you all had knowledge of typical Prothean ruins. And while you were there looking around, suddenly up on this large structure in front of you, this being composed of these sharp shards of yellow light appeared out of nowhere. And as suddenly as it arrived, it started basically blinking towards the rest of you and began to charge. And that is when Miles opened fire. So that is immediately where we will return. Miles, would you please roll a ranged combat check? Now this is going to be, this thing is effectively getting very close to you, so it's gonna be close range, so a very easy hit. It is moving extremely fast, however, so I'm gonna say a setback die, but you also have the quick draw talent, so I'm gonna get rid of that setback die. So.
Okay. You want me to just shoot it? Just
go ahead and just do whatever you were doing in this moment. All right, that is an incredible shot. So you, what weapon are you using here? This is your assault rifle?
Yes.
You quickly level your assault rifle at this thing, and with expert grouping, just fire burst after burst. And as you do, you can see that this thing, sort of bits of sparks are flying off of it, and it clearly feels the impact of getting shot, and it blinks out of existence once again. And all the rest of you can hear is just the echoing sound of Miles' shots echoing throughout this ruin.
That was close. You okay?
What was this?
If anyone would know, it's you. So that doesn't bode well.
Well, would I need to roll for something if I would know anything about this?
Yeah, why don't you go ahead and roll knowledge just to see... knowledge or archaeology, your choice, to see if you have any idea if this is anything that ties into that particular
history. Said knowledge or
archaeology.
Okay.
Wow, that's a fascinating roll. That's failure technically with a triumph and a lot of advantage. Incredible.
That's just weird.
as far as you can tell, based on the short amount of time you got to see this thing, you don't know what it is. But it does seem, let's see, it seems reminiscent of some kind of VI program, but also not that, to be extremely unhelpful to you. It has sort of similar properties. You're curious if this is some sort of Prothean VI, maybe a defense mechanism of some kind. It's not entirely clear to you.
Okay.
But yeah, you also get a triumph. So we can say that in that moment, it has sort of given you a profound sort of understanding or insight into this place. So say it from now on, any further checks you do relating to any of the Prothean ruins here can be made with an automatic upgrade.
Oh, nice. That's good. So this might have been a VI or some security system.
Great.
Can I turn it on? Can I turn on this system? Whatever it is?
There's currently no access point that you can readily see to interface or something like that.
What would it take to search for an access point?
You would just basically have to look around and find something that you would think resembles some kind of interface console. So if you want to, you can just do perception.
Can I help with that?
Absolutely. So you can get an automatic blue to that as well.
Staying on guard in case blue. It comes back.
Sounds good. Okay.
Ready to roll.
All right. It doesn't actually take you too long between Talora and Kalor looking around for any kind of access point. You soon find various mechanical devices that appear to be effectively consoles that are just set up coming out of the ground. You can see that there's quite a few of these here. They all appear to be lacking any kind of power, though. so nothing that you do with it appears to have much result.
We need to find the power source.
Okay.
It also means that whatever we're seeing in these ruins is probably not due to this, because it's not connected.
Would I know what the power supply looks like in the Protheans, or what, you know, we have to look for to, you know, power it up?
You would know the basics of what, once you saw a generator of some kind, you would maybe, you know what it is. The matter is, where would that be? That is something you are unsure of in a place like this.
Okay. Well, if I see it, you know, I'll be able to tell it, but I'm not quite sure where it would be.
And Mars, while you're keeping
tearing
up
the floorboards, but I don't think that's going to help.
Go ahead and do perception for you as well, Miles, as you're keeping watch.
Duke. Still don't have it.
All right. Okay. You're keeping an eye out for danger, and it doesn't take too long as your allies are sort of roaming around this rather Spartan ruin that you find yourselves in, as they're looking at the consoles trying to figure out power, that you see a... you basically identify in a couple of places. This place is a sort of multi-storied, as though it's got like numerous structures within the ruins itself. You can see that there are a few sort of corridors and doorways where there is a faint amount of this sort of purplish blue light. And as you sort of adjust your visors, sort of listening instruments as well, you can hear the occasional cry or moan or otherwise sort of beleaguered sound coming from someone or something within this place.
All right, lead on, Doc. You want to go in that scary tunnel or the other one?
Well, could I make an educated guess which one would lead us to the power stuff? Which one would...
Go ahead.
Yes.
Go ahead and roll Knowledge or Archaeology again, and we'll add your reply or upgrade.
Yeah.
Well...
Yep, you make a guess, and you go that way.
Yes, I guessed.
Effectively, where you find yourself right now is a singular unit of some description, although there's, you know, some smaller structures within. Decide that this is probably not the place you're looking for, so you look for a way beyond this place, and soon enough you find a large doorway that leads to what is effectively a long bridge that leads to another sort of central hub. And you can see that, well, actually you can see very little in this place, because while you've been here, you've noted that there are a couple of generators and spotlights that have been set up that have the sort of IMC logo on them, so the miners clearly hauled those in here, but otherwise everything else is completely dark. But you can see that there is basically a long bridge with a little bit of light in it that just goes into darkness, and that's effectively it.
Can we look around, just investigate and see what we can find?
In terms of sort of pursuing this path, or
some clues. Maybe it was he here, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. If you'd like to sort of get more sort of concrete information on the people who have been here, yeah, anybody can go ahead and roll perception for that.
Stick up to advantage.
Talora, as you're looking around, basically it's too dark for you to really notice anything. You can potentially try and like bring the lights with you, or just kind of continue on and hope you find some more further in, or just, you know, light up your armor and just have a very limited field of vision. Talora, as you're sort of looking around this place, you find something rather unusual. And you're with Sani at this time, and you can see there is basically a very small plinth And on top of it, there is this little sort of metal shard that is just gently floating above it. And it looks important. It is one of the few things here that actually has any kind of sort of slight light on it, a little bit of indication of power there.
Well.
Okay.
I'll grab it.
You reach out to grab it. And as you do so, things start to feel very strange in your brain. As a lot of information is suddenly pumped into your mind. Would you mind rolling for me a resilience, discipline. Oh no, resilience check.
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Nope. You're going to take 3 points of strain as your mind is overwhelmed with this sort of disparate information that you can't really make much use of. But you rolled one advantage, so I'm going to say from this experience you gain 5 experience points. So maybe there is something within that knowledge that would just burst into your brain that you could use it somehow. But as you go through this, you suddenly feel a massive headache and a flash of just technological nonsense in your mind. And Sani kind of comes over to you a little bit concerned, and you see that directly behind her, that entity composed of these sharp shards of light has appeared once more.
I'm going to pocket the shard.
Okay.
And I'm just going to silently point behind her.
Okay. She kind of like looks at you like very concerned that you just kind of like reeled from your experience just then. She's just like, was that a smart thing to do? We probably shouldn't just be touching things. And then
round.
She slowly turns around. And immediately this strange light composed entity just like raises a hand to her face with blinding speed, and you just hear this horrible screeching sound like a broken can opener, just and then you hear the entity sort of speaking in a language you understand strangely, and it says commencing interface, and then it disappears.
Push her out of the way. Can I push her out of the way?
Yes, oh. Absolutely. You push her and it disappears from view.
You saw that, right? It wasn't just me.
There is no response from Sani.
Okay, how do I wake her up? Let's wake her up. Medicine?
Yeah, you can actually roll medicine to see how she's doing after that. Mars and Talora, I imagine you're both fairly close by. Talora, you're a little bit lost right now, so you hear this happening, but you're still making your way back to the group. Miles, you can be wherever you would like to be at this moment.
I would have stuck with Talora.
Got it. Okay. Alright, so Kalor, you inspect your quarrying companion to see what the heck just happened. Was it something similar to what just happened to you? She seems unresponsive right now. You get kind of close to her visor, and you can see that her eyes are doing rapid eye movement. And you can tell that she's breathing. Her heart rate is increasing terrifyingly quickly. And her breathing is getting extremely fast as well. And after a few short moments, she just screams. And it is a scream of horror that rings out within these hollow ruins that you find yourselves in. And you can see that there is this sort of bluish, purplish energy being emitted from her eyes.
And I'm familiar with Quarian suits. Can I use my knowledge of Quarian suits to get it to release some form of like sedative?
Yeah, absolutely. You can indeed. Just go ahead and do a do another medicine check.
Of course. Good at that.
All right. Yes. So I imagine like all Quarian suits have like a repository of like basic medical stuff in them. So you're able to basically do a very quick override to help her out and insert these sedatives. When you do so, you can see an immediate sort of slight decrease to her heart rate, to her breathing and everything. But she is still sort of like writhing a little bit, although a little bit sluggish now. And you can see that from her visor, this light has now become so strong that it's just forming something before your eyes. And suddenly it flashes, and you can see effectively specters of Quarians running nearby you. And one of them even kind of like bumps into you a little bit. And while they're semi-tangible, you can sort of feel a little bit of force from them bumping into you. And they're sort of walking forward, a big group of Quarians. and you can see that from one of them, a single beam of this purplish-blue light grows into a perfect straight line and seems to just extend further and further and further into the distance.
I run after the blue line.
Okay. You can quickly see that it is going up at such an angle that you'll need to sort of climb some nearby ancient technology or architecture to follow wherever it's going.
I'm as careful as possible so I don't press any buttons so I don't end up collapsing, but yes.
Making sure you don't accidentally pick up three more shards along your way. Excellent. Go ahead and just roll athletics to see how well you can climb up there. All right. I'll say this. You managed to do so with such efficacy that you can get one strain back. But it does take you a little while finding a nice, stable route. Even as you climb onto one piece of tech, you can feel a little bit of it give way underneath you. Clearly this stuff has been here for a very long time and is not in very good condition. But eventually you manage to make your way up to where you saw this blue line going. And you can hear Sani, the screaming has stopped at this point, but she is kind of captivated with what she's seeing around her. When you get close to where the blue line was going, you see that it starts to basically branch out like a root system and start to make something take form. And you can see what's taking form is this big sniper rifle and then a creature holding it. And you recognize the silhouette of this creature as a Geth. And then moments later, you hear ghostly Geth fires a shot, and looking down, you can see that it impacts one of the ghostly quarians, and they fall to the ground screaming in pain. And then suddenly, you can see that there's numerous Geth ghosts all around, perched on different parts of this chamber that you find yourself in, firing at the ghostly quarians. And you can hear Sani screaming, watching these fellows getting shot down.
Okay, I'm going to pull out the data shard and try to access it again, whatever it is.
Yeah, you touch it and no response, nothing happens. Unless you would like to, like, interface it with your Omnitool somehow, or, like, rub it between your palms.
Yeah, I'm going to rub it between my palms. Can I spend a story point?
Yes.
To try and activate it again?
Okay, sounds good. As far as you can tell, there is no button on this device. It's completely smooth. But yes, you can absolutely spend a story point to basically make some kind of connection work with this thing. And once again, you feel a flash of information flooding your senses. My question for you is what kind of insight or knowledge or whatever were you trying to get from this device?
How do I make these apparitions stop? How do I stabilize these people?
Interesting. You basically, through the flashes of memories that go through your mind, you get a very brief glimpse of some person by the name of Arzia Vriss, the head researcher who has the credentials to override what is called Project... Anamnesis.
Good lord.
Yep. Meanwhile, Miles and Talora, I assume that with all the commotion going on, you try to return to everything's happening here. Is that true?
Enough screaming to get us to come over, I think.
Yeah. Yes. You basically see your quarian companion, Sani. No sign of where Kalora is at the moment, but Sani is basically crouched down, and she is crouched down next to another sort of ghostly specter of another quarian. Meanwhile, you can see there's a bunch of sort of these blue laser beams all around in front of them, and a lot of dead specter quarians as well. And you can see that Sani is just utterly awestruck by this, and the specter next to her turns to her and says, "You need to get out of here. Go back to the ship. Tell them what happened. Go. I'll cover your escape." And Sani just kind of like snaps her head up, looks, and goes, "No, no, not again, please. No, not again." And then the spectre next to her says, "Just go!" And the spectre sort of pushes at Sani, but doesn't have a huge effect, and then sort of rears up, fires a rifle in the direction of the laser beams that you can see, and very shortly you can see that they get shot multiple times.
Where the hell is Kaelor? I don't know what I should do. I'll run over to her and like try to restrain her from doing anything too dangerous.
Okay. You can see that she is clearly not herself right now. She's sort of screaming, writhing. You can see that there is sort of like this weird purplish bluish energy that has like these very thin energy tethers to everything that's going on here, and they're slowly fading as well. And she seems kind of unresponsive to you for the most part. She's clearly in a lot of shock right now.
Can I see that original VI anywhere?
No sign of it.
And can I do a medicine check and see if I can help calm her down? Because, you know, I might not be a Quarian, but I might, you know, be able to maybe give her some more sedatives.
Absolutely. Go ahead and roll medicine again. While you're doing that, Kalor, you notice that the Geth sniper who you are next to right now, as you're sort of going through this information with the with this device that you have, you see that it's archetypical flashlight head slowly turns to you, and it quickly rears its rifle in your direction.
Rather than run away, I'm going to try and grab the rifle away from it.
Okay. Go ahead and roll melee, and let's see how this goes. Meanwhile, Talora, you very quickly manage to locate what is effectively the way to get more sedative into this Quarian, and you can see that Sani very quickly manages to calm down and seems to just like slow down and go a little bit limp in your arms as well. And she seems like she'll sort of be a bit more relaxed from now at the very least. And then you see that sort of on the center of your body, one of these long laser beams is pointing at you, and Miles, same for you as well. And as Kalor tries to wrestle this sniper rifle from this ghostly Geth, we're going to roll initiative, everybody.
I undo that last player's story point use because I didn't actually use it.
Oh, I see. No worries.
And initiative.
Cool or vigilance?
This will be vigilance.
Whoa! Sixth advantage.
Wow. Such an advantageous nice position. Alright. So let me roll for these. Geth. These are no good Geth. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right. Miles, are you going to use your rapid reaction or anything? Or are you good to go?
I think not. I think I underestimate these ghosts. Like, my initial thing is these aren't real. They're just holographic projections. They can't do anything. Mm-hmm. So.
Sounds good. All right. So first up, we have a PC slot. So who would like to take that and what would they like to do? Kalor, you currently are in a contest with this one Geth sniper, and you successfully managed to sort of seize the rifle. As far as you can tell, it's a little bit half existing and half not.
I feel like I could just easily point it at the Geth and shoot and see what happens.
Absolutely. If you would like to do that as your first turn, please feel free to.
I'm going to. All right. I'm going to. Suck at range.
It's going to be a close range shot with a sniper rifle, so it's going to be difficulty of 2. What else?
Is it light or heavy?
This is a heavy ranged. And you're technically engaged right now, so I think that also increases the difficulty by 1 again. And it's a two-handed weapon, so that increases the difficulty again.
Sure.
But with that all gone, go ahead and fire when ready.
Wow.
Incredible. So you take this like weirdly half tangible item that like is sort of reverberating in your hands a little bit, and you point it towards this geth, and you pull what is, you assume, the trigger, and it fires and it blasts this geth for a total of, that's going to be 11 points of damage. And as you fire, you basically can feel a sort of loss of stability in the thing you were shooting at and in the rifle you're holding as well, as if the two were one. And you can see these weird sort of like reverberating pulses and ripples go throughout this geth creature. It is reminiscent to you of some kind of biotic force or some kind of like Mass Effect field being manipulated somehow. You also get two disadvantage on that. So I'm going to say with that... how is your strain looking? We're going to say this entire experience is going to give you 2 points of strain damage.
Yep. I'm at 8 strain. This is great. I like this.
All right. So with that, next up is an NPC slot. One of the geth snipers is going to shoot at you, Miles. This is at long range. So this is going to be a difficulty of 3. And they're going to fire their rifle. Here we go. They fire out. Oh, no. So Miles, you're going to take 13 points of damage. And that's also... 13 points of damage. It's also a critical hit. So please roll on your critical injuries a roll as well.
Let's see. Where's that? Critical injuries. There. And then I... There we go.
All right. Let's see. Again, as with Erda, we'll say that this isn't quite as bad as it appears. But basically, one of your limbs gets seriously impaired. As you're kind of gauging the situation for danger, you are shot right in... I'll let you decide what.
Leg?
Right in the leg. And it smarts so hard, Miles, to the degree where you know, it's a big wake-up call of just like, oh, these things are extremely dangerous. So cool. Now anything you do, add 1 setback dice to any leg actions. Good to know. Moving forward. All right, another NPC turn. Talora, one of the geth echoes is going to fire at you as well. And that is going to be 11 damage to you. Talora, do you currently have your tech armor up?
Yes.
You do. Okay. So that's going to be, you have a soak of 2 then, which is ignored because it has pierce.
3. Soak of 3.
Oh, a soak of 3. It is unfortunately still ignored because they have a pierce of 3. So that's going to be a total of 11 damage to you.
To the shields first. Okay.
Yes. He also generated a little bit of disadvantage from that, so... this particular geth fighter loses a little bit of stability from that. And you notice as well, these things are... Well, I guess, Kalor, you would notice more than anybody else that while these things are definitely reminiscent of geth, they have accentuated features. Almost like this sort of demonic aspects to them. As though they are out of a nightmare rather than what is... true. Another NPC's turn. Hold on. Did I get this completely wrong? No, this is just in a weird place.
Before that happens,
yes.
I'm going to use a story point, and Erda's going to shoot the next one.
Oh, beautiful. Love that. All right, Erda, emerging from the shadows, is going to fire at one of the geth, or the next geth that's about to go. Would anybody like to roll for her, or should I roll? Would you like to do the honors?
I don't trust my rolling. So.
Okay.
Well, you took the story point, though.
Okay, yeah, I'll roll. Character right. Sheet.
One sec. Let me just set the difficulty. It's going to be difficulty of 3 for long range. Or is it 4 for long range? I don't remember. I think it's 3.
Wait. Does Erda have no points in range?
Yeah, here's the thing about Erda. She has a sniper rifle. She's still practicing with it. If you go ahead
did
and
did she spend her XP? Can we give her a point of that?
I don't want to make that choice for her character at this stage, unfortunately.
I agree.
So when you're ready, go ahead and just go to her weapons page and click her Mantis rifle, and that will fire a shot.
Weapons page.
Mantis rifle is...
I think I just skipped over entire weapon section. Hold
up. It's called Mantis, I think. This is all extremely... This is her using her concentration mod, just very slowly lining up the shot. Oh! Erda's best shot of her career! Wow. That is going to be... What is that? That's 8 plus 4 for a total of 12 damage! You hear the resounding sound of the Mantis rifle being fired, and Erda has an upgrade to her cloak where she's not uncloaked after a single shot of power, so she's still invisible. You just hear this Guardian Angel shot fire out as it slams into this Geth. Unfortunately, it does get a shot off. It is not destroyed from that shot, though it is extremely impaired. You can see its entire form reverberating and vibrating, losing its structure. But it is going to turn its ghostly rifle towards you, Kalor, and take a shot.
Mm-hmm.
So that's going to be... Ooh! And it goes wide. It seems like it got a bit staggered from Erda's shot, and Kalor, you can see like a piece of ancient tech next to you just explodes, but you are fine.
All right. That's terrifying.
That leads it to the last NPC shot. This last Geth is going to fire at Sani, who is currently sort of taking cover, posing no threat whatsoever. So here we go. Bang. And she gets hit for 12 damage. And she crumples to the floor from that. Next up, PC slot. Who would like to go?
I already went.
Yeah. All right, Miles, what are you going to do?
So I'm lying on the floor with a non-functional leg.
It's severely impaired. It's somewhat functional, we'll say.
Yeah, so I think that's a good reason to go into an adrenaline rush, because that's what happens when you get injured. So I will do the athletics roll thing.
All right, sounds good. Using your prowess. Oh, beautiful roll. So you're going to do plus 2 damage with all attacks this turn.
Yeah. Okay, I will also heal for 9 now.
Yes, upping your shields thanks to your upgrade to your adrenaline rush.
Very, very important. Putting me back on a far more comfortable 16. Okay, I'll use... Oh, I also have to spend strain. One second.
At least you're good.
Very strained now. I'll use my fitness to get a second maneuver off. I'll use disruptor ammo. That's my first maneuver to turn that on.
Hell yeah.
I will get into cover, because I wasn't. I'll crawl into cover, and as I do, I'll shoot one of the baddies.
Sounds good. Of these ones, which would you like to shoot?
The closest one. I'm not fussed. I'm far too distracted to be smart about this.
Fair enough. All right. Yeah, they're basically set up at various elevations around you. We'll say the closest one to you is actually the one that Kalor is currently engaged with. So go ahead and let me just set the difficulty here. Roll when you're ready.
All right, and...
Oh, beautiful shot.
That's real good. That is real good.
Your ammo empowered with the power of disruption. You can see these blue streaks flying through the air, and they slam into the ghostly echo of the Geth that you're effectively wrestling with right now, Kalor. And as these electrical payloads burst, the creature completely disappears and dissipates into nothingness.
Imagine my spectral gun disappears too.
Correct, unfortunately. beautiful turn, Miles. Anything else? Or is that it? Are you good?
I think that's it, right?
Sounds good. All right, that brings it to Talora. Talora, you just got shot. A lot of Geth ghosts around. What are you doing?
Where exactly am I in relation to the others and the Geth?
You are basically next to Sani and Miles, nearby what is some kind of a Prothean tech or architecture that you could conceivably take cover by. Otherwise, Kalor is up on this like small structure, and there are other structures nearby where the Geth are hiding and aiming their lasers at all of you.
Okay. I would like to get into cover.
Okay. It's going to be a maneuver to get to cover. Sounds good.
Yes. And I would like to... Okay, so how does it work with the cryoblast? Because that works with my ammo, right?
No, that's cryo ammo. Your cryoblast is a separate ability that just targets one okay. person.
Okay. So she will whip out her shuriken and she will shoot the one that's hard.
Sounds good. What's the range on your shuriken?
Medium.
Unfortunately, you are too far away to effectively target that geth. They are all at long range away from you. You could spend a maneuver to get closer for that, or...
Okay. Okay, so, Cryoblast doesn't even say anything.
In terms of range?
Yeah, well, I'm blind. No, medium range, never mind. Right, but Miles is right next to me, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Can I try and use my medicine with my surgeon skills?
Yeah, absolutely. You can try and... well, he's actually not wounded right now. He took all the damage to his shield.
But his legs.
Oh, right.
Because if I can... If I use my surgeon skills for the medicine, I can take care of the wound, basically.
Okay. Yeah, this is going to be... high pressure on a lot of duress, so you're going to get two setback dice for this. Miles, what is the difficulty rating of that injury? How many blips does it have next to it?
I don't know.
Scrolling up.
Oh, yeah, there we go. I have two off balance, which I think is gone now.
That unfortunately does not disappear until it is healed, but the effect is gone.
Really? But it's add one setback die to the next... Oh, okay, the effect is gone. All right.
I thought I healed that. Huh.
No, that didn't. That happened last time, I think.
Oh, because I wasn't there. Yeah, that was my plan.
Big beast monster.
Before I got unconscious, yeah, that was my plan.
So what do we want?
Is there a difficulty or a number of blips next to your critical injury?
There's three blips.
Three blips. Okay, so that's how difficult it is to heal. Sounds great. So with that in mind, go ahead and roll.
Can I use a story point to up my
upgrade? Absolutely.
Yes.
Go ahead and spend that.
Okay.
Yeah, okay, and so, roll when you're
so
ready.
She will crawl over to him and she will try and heal his wounds on his leg.
Oh, amazing. So you succeed. Miles, I'm going to say you take a point of strain as Dolores is not being delicate in this moment.
Yay.
But your severely impeded legs, she slaps some Metagel on there and basically very roughly gets your leg back to at least a functional state again.
So it says when making a medicine check to heal wounds, the target heals one additional wound per rank of surgeon. Does that mean I heal both?
No, because these are critical injuries, not wounds. Those are two separate things.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
So does it remove blips of it, or...?
No, it means the entire injury is gone for you, Miles. So now you're only
all gone.
Affected by the off-balance. Now, critical injuries can only be attempted to be healed once every week, so very good work there, Talora.
I have removed the critical injury.
Sounds great. All right, that brings it to a new round, a new PC slot. Who would like to go?
Sure. I'm going to just pull up, say I'm going to spend 7 strain this turn. So these geths, the rest of the geth, are they close together?
They are not, unfortunately. They are all separated at different levels, different distances.
Maybe I'll only spend 3 strain then. I'm going to pick one in long range with like the 13 out of 14 one, and I'm going to charge at it.
Oh, biotic charge. Love it. Yep. All right. What is required for that?
I need to roll biotics against the resilience.
Okay, let me check its resilience. That is going to be 2 purples for that. So let me set that difficulty. And roll when you're ready.
Of course, I'm more than happy to.
I'm going to actually spend a story point to make that harder. Ooh. So,
well, I'm going to have to re-roll.
So I'm going to use a story point. It's going to be a bit harder because they're intangible. Who knows if biotics even function the same way with this thing. So go ahead and roll again. Sorry about that. Hey.
It's better. It's fine.
It never mattered. All right. You instantly teleport and slam your full mass increased force into this Geth Echo. And what does that do?
8 damage.
8 damage. Goodness. You slam into it. And you also get, we'll say, a strain back from that advantage.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm more than happy to. So, I only lost 2 there. Now I'm going to Biotic Melee.
I love it. All right, that's going to be a difficulty of 2 again. So go ahead and roll when you're ready.
Of course. This time I'll be spending a story point, so I can actually get a yellow from there.
Oh, let me upgrade that for you. Boop. All right.
Yeah.
Oh, critical hit! That's an auto crit. What does it look like when Kalor does a biotic melee? And also, what horrible, brutal thing do you do to destroy this Geth?
Well, usually Kalor's like, he's not very well trained, but he knows which target spots to hit. And for a Geth, it's always right in the right in the flashlight, as we like to put it.
Low blow.
So I think in this case, Kalor's biotic fist goes right into the flashlight and just keeps going. And whatever used to be there is straight up atomized.
Incredible. Absolutely incredible. Yeah, the forces that seem to be making up this sort of ghostly Geth immediately get disrupted by your biotics that just overwhelm and overpower them. And it's just a big explosion of energy, leaving your fist just smoldering.
I can spend 2 strain to do another maneuver, right?
That is correct.
Let's, I pick another Geth in long range.
Get a charge again.
And we're doing this again.
All right, sounds good. You want to go for the wounded one or an unwounded one? Unwounded one.
Unwounded one.
All right, sounds good. We'll just say this one. All right, that's going to be another, just roll same thing again. I will spend another story point to make this slightly harder for you, sorry.
Well, damn it.
Swings and roundabouts.
I could have gotten a triumph out of that.
All right, you slam as both of you on the ground can hear the sound of these biotic explosions as Kalora is just zipping between these Geth, slamming them with his biotic fists. Truly impressive display. And you have 1 strain left, Kalora. Oh no.
I'm fine.
Incredible.
I'm fine.
Incredible. Is that everything for your turn? Is there anything you can do?
I'm gonna just shrug at Talora because it's the first time she's seen my biotics.
Sounds good. All right.
I have this image where I'm like trying to shoot one and then Kalora kills it. Okay, get the next one. Same thing.
It's my entire experience playing Mass Effect multiplayer. It's like, oh, perfect shot. Vanguard comes in. Damn it, man. incredible. Great work. NPC slot this turn. The one that you charge into, Kalor, is going to turn to you and effectively try and just bash you with its rifle with a melee attack. So I'm also going to spend a story point for this because these guys can see all the help they can get.
As long as they don't take strain.
And
same way. Full shields, full health, 1 strain.
Awesome. I rolled very badly. Kalor, you expertly managed to dodge out of the way of this Geth's attack against you. And yeah, everything's good. Everything's fine. It does get an advantage. I'm going to say it gets a blue to its next attack. All right, another NPC slot. This time, the other 2 echoes that remain that aren't currently engaged with Kalor, their beams focus in. And even sort of towards where your cover is, Miles, you can see that they are aimed directly at your chest. And based on the impact you just felt, you get the feeling that these weapons can fairly easily shoot through cover. So you have 2 beams aimed at you, and that's going to end their turn. And with that...
They're just aiming? Okay.
Correct. And with that... they are also... They're doing an action called Assassinate, which is going to give them some nice stuff, but they're also going to use a maneuver to aim. Thanks for reminding me that they can do that. And with that, I'm going to get rid of these other 2 NPC slots because they got biotically obliterated by Kalor. Brings it to PC slot. Miles or Talora, who wants to go?
I will.
Yeah. Are they in medium or in long range?
They're still at long range.
Dang.
I'll aim for one and just shoot him.
Sounds great. Let me set the difficulty there. Long range. Go for it. Oh, never mind. Go for it now when I actually apply your aim. My apologies.
But I've got two successes. I'm fine with this.
It might be better.
Oh. See, there you go. See, this is why.
I'm so sorry.
This is why.
You fire a salvo at this thing, but they are keeping you too pinned down. As you kind of like rear your head up, it looks too dangerous, and you duck back down again. You do get advantage though, so you could either boost somebody or get a string back, your choice.
String.
Sounds great. All right, and it brings it to you, Talora. What would you like to do this time?
Can I actually make it into medium range?
Yeah, that costs a maneuver to move a range band. The big thing is just you'll be out in the open, unless you also use another maneuver to get to cover.
Well, that will have to see how I roll, right? If I can do that. All right, so what I want to do is I want to get to medium, and I want to use throw on one of them.
A biotic throw, beautiful. Sounds great. What do they need to do against that, or what do you need to do?
It says biotics versus simple difficulty.
Cool. That's and then love it.
Yes, and you rapidly reduce the weight of a foe, then impact them with the concentrated mass effect. As an action, you throw a vulnerable enemy you can see within medium range, pushing them one range band, plus one range band for every SS success.
Oh, yeah. Unfortunately,
knocking them prone.
None of these Geth Echoes are considered vulnerable right now, as they are composed of biotic shields. Or barriers, I should say.
Well, fine. Then I'm going to cryoblast one of them.
All right. Sounds good.
Fine. That is mechanics versus simple difficulty.
All right. Go ahead and roll when you're ready. All right. Interesting. So that's three advantages. Does that do anything on a cryoblast?
Says so an action, you can freeze an enemy you can see within medium range. Targets take additional damage from all sources equal to nope. But I have enough of these that I can get into cover.
Sounds right? Good. Yes, you can absolutely use those to get a free maneuver.
Okay. So I want to get into cover and then add one of the things to the next allies check.
Great. Excellent. Blue. Sounds
right?
Good.
Baby blue.
Yes,
looks like
absolutely.
Baby blue.
All right, so through her heroic leaping over cover and running closer to the enemies, she provides a nice amount of distraction that either one of you can exploit later on. And it is another PC slot. Who would like to go?
Are we done? Didn't we all go?
It's
a new round. Mm-hmm. I have to make up for my shitty last turn.
All right. So let's see. You were aiming.
If you wouldn't mind.
Absolutely. So long range.
Yeah. Still same. Aim fire.
Sounds good. Go ahead and roll.
You added the extra one.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Hey.
Much better.
Beautiful shot. Miles, was any one of these three that you were aiming at in particular?
Just the closest one.
Just the closest.
One of the ones that is trying to shoot me.
Well, okay.
That seems
good.
Smart.
All right, so you hit this one. It only has two barriers left. It gets utterly obliterated with an incredible salvo of shots that you basically... It's like the sort of like heart-heart, face-face. And you expertly manage to like shoot this thing, and it is destroyed.
Excellent.
And its little beam that it was aiming directly towards you fades and disappears. Great work there.
Anything
else?
Recover one strain.
Sounds great. All right. NPC turn. The one aiming at you is going to fire. So it's going to be long range. It was aiming, and I'm going to spend a story point to upgrade its attack. As you manage to bring down one of them, you hear a shot, and you get hit for 13 points of damage.
That's a lot of damage.
As this thing fires at you.
Good lord.
Oh, actually, plus an additional 3 because it uses assassination ability, so a total of 16 damage.
You don't have shields anymore, do you?
Yeah.
Oof. There's a sudden static
discharge.
You know
what that means for Mass Effect, that it's time to just hunker behind the cover and wait.
Behind the convenient waist-high walls everywhere nearby. Yep. Excellent. So that was that NPC's turn. It's going to spend a maneuver to aim at you again. Another NPC. This one is next to you, Kalor. It is going to try and shoot you, which is questionable to do at this kind of range, but we'll see how it goes. So, sniper rifle is hard. Two-weapon is hard. And what are the other things?
Engaged.
Right. So difficulty of 4 for this shot. Goodness. This is a bad idea. All right. It's going to swing around, try and blast you. And it's going to get... Da-da-da-da. Oh, goodness.
Good lord.
It's going to be 13 damage against you, Kalor. But it does get 4 threat. And we'll say that that manifests right now as... how does this manifest? I'm going to say you can take an immediate maneuver.
Okay.
And in addition, it's going to add a setback die to its next check.
By immediate, is it possible to aim a melee shot?
Yes, it is.
Well, I'm aiming.
Okay, excellent. So you're setting up.
Straight in the flashlights.
Straight in the flashlights. Beautiful. And with that, the other one is gone. So another PC slot again. Who would like to go?
Let's do it.
All right, Kalor, you're face to face with this Geth sniper Echo. What do you do?
Well, we're going to use a player story point because, again, we want to make sure this works.
Sounds good.
And melee time.
One sec. Let me just apply a bonus and your upgrade, and you're good to go. Ooh!
Well, can I recover strain?
Yes, you can definitely recover up to 2 strain with that roll. As you swing out, you're not sure if it just dodged you or if there's something about the sort of partial intangibility of it that you just weren't able to connect with, but you do not think you do much damage to this thing. Anything else, Claw?
Yeah, sure. I'm going to... Hold on. There we go. I am going to... I'm gonna hide.
That's what I'm gonna hide.
Do. I'm just gonna. I'm gonna jump behind cover.
Got it. Wonderful. All right, and that brings it to our final PC slot, which I believe is to Laura.
All right. So she's in cover and she's in medium range.
Correct.
Right. So the one that's hard is with Kalor, right?
Yes, that's right.
And then there's the other one who's aiming at Miles. So the one that's aiming at Miles, I wanna use the maneuver to aim, and then shoot him with my shuriken.
Beautiful. All right. So it's medium range. That's difficulty of this, I think. You're aiming, so plus 1 blue die. All right. Go ahead and roll when you're ready. Hey, with that, you fire your submachine gun, and it deals 5 damage to this thing. Excellent.
And remember, it's rapid, so it has 1 extra damage to shields.
Correct. This is a barrier that it has, unfortunately, so that does not apply.
Too bad. Too bad.
So to blue health bars, that would affect, but not to purple ones. But a very fine hit, regardless. You can see as your bullets kind of pierce this thing, just sending ripples throughout its form, making it become less stable. Anything else with your turn, Talora?
No, I don't have anything left. Nope.
All right. Sounds good. New round, new PC slot. Who would like to go?
Biotic punch again.
Hey, love it. All right, Kalor, you're face-to-face this
game. Punch!
What would you like to do?
Once again, I'm going to be as careful as possible.
Okay.
Right at the flashlights. Come on.
Let's see it. Let's do this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Oh, hold on. Are you taking a maneuver to aim this shot, or are you just doing a regular punch?
Just doing regular punch.
Regular punch. All right, go for it. As your fist lights up. Oh, that's a critical biotic punch, everybody. Would you like to once again describe how you obliterate this thing with your nothing but your fist?
This time it's not a fist. It's a biotic knee to the gut. And there's a brief image of every single, like an arm, another arm, the legs just blowing up around this thing before it all fizzles out of existence.
Incredible. Absolutely incredible. Yeah, this thing is utterly obliterated with your biotic prowess. Sending out this like little shock wave throughout this chamber. Incredible. Anything else, Claw?
I'm going to use the next maneuver to get behind cover.
All right, sounds good. NPC slot this time. This guest sniper is going to take cover. And then, that's about all it can really do at this stage. It's going to take cover. And this NPC slot is gone. New PC slot. Who would like to take it?
Sure. I guess I'll try to shoot it.
Go
from
it,
cover.
Miles. All right. So it's difficulty of 3. It is taking cover. And I'm going to spend a story point to make this a bit harder.
Gonna fire.
Holding your aiming.
Is
let me just
cover?
Affect that. All right. Go ahead and roll. Oh, yes. You just hit it. Managing to deal a total of, what is that, 6 damage. Great work there.
Cool.
As your bullets slam into it, like the slight bits of it that are sticking out of cover, you manage to expertly snipe. And you get 2 advantage. Go ahead and spend those however you would like.
I'm going to regenerate some shields, which gives me 6.
Beautiful. All right, so that brings it back to you, Talora, again. Only one of these Geth Echoes left, as far as you can tell.
All right. Aim and shoot it.
Okay, let me set that up. Aiming. And okay, go ahead and roll. Oh, another brilliant shot for 4 damage. That is just enough to take this thing out. And basically the last shot you fire, you hear the beeping, the warning sounds coming from your weapon as it overheats and you pop out the thermal clip. Would you like to describe how you obliterate this final Geth Echo?
Yeah, she's just like behind cover and she's aiming. And she's like, N-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-n-
And with that burst of fire, it is obliterated from existence. Excellent work, everybody. As far as you can tell, there are no more of these weird Geth echoes around. You do notice, however, that the Quarian ghostly figures are still there, just rather morbidly just lying dead on the ground as part of this ambush. But it all goes quiet at this stage.
All right, we gotta get this thing turned off right now. We can't survive another one of these.
Protein researcher. You need to find a protein researcher.
No.
Right, what is, how is our other Quarian doing?
She is currently unconscious on the ground, and you can see that there is blood rupturing from her suit.
All right, so Talora will hastily make her way over there and roll medicine to try and help her.
Sounds good. Yeah, go ahead and roll medicine.
Hold up.
I'll actually give you a little boost because she's sedated as well.
Yeah, and I have 2 Medi-Gel.
Oh.
Is that something that I will... I don't know how that works.
So the way that difficulty for medicine checks is determined is how much of your wounds are currently taken down. So if you would like this medicine check to be easier, using Medi-Gel first will help. If you don't really care about that too much and would like to see how your medicine check goes first and then think about spending Medi-Gel, you can also do that too.
All right, then let's roll first.
Sounds good. All right, just roll medicine.
Right.
All right. With that, you manage to... You can see that the Quarian suit is very sophisticated. It is very effectively kind of compartmentalized the wound, and you sort of help out... ensuring that everything is sort of cleaned and that she's getting the medical care she needs. Unfortunately, you do know for a fact, as a Quarian, she is going to be suffering from an infection in the immediate future as a result. But yeah. She is alive and she is stable. She's effectively maxed out on strain right now, so just not particularly responsive to anything you're saying.
All right. Right, so... Can we check around where we are and see if there was, is there anything interesting in this area before we move on? Because there was a big fight here, but was it about what's here or was it just because there were opposing forces?
As you ask that, Talora, you can hear that Sunny is sort of trying to say something to you. And as she does, there is a sudden flash, and you can see that before your eyes, the sort of entity composed of these light shards has appeared once again in front of all of you, and you hear it say, extraction complete, memory full, disengaging. and it fizzles and kind of pops to another location and starts sort of quickly blink teleporting its way away from the rest of you.
Can I follow?
Absolutely, you can follow.
No recovering for strain for me.
Oh no. You all can recover your shields and barriers though. And actually, Miles and Flora, if you don't want to follow Kalor, you could also take a
absolutely
a
not
breather. All right.
Nope. So we're not letting him go alone.
Again, is it discipline that we roll?
It's either discipline or cool to recover strain.
Okay.
Okay.
Cool is what I have. Nice.
All right, so that's two strain back for Miles.
Hold up. What was discipline or?
Or cool, your choice.
All right. Discipline it is.
And while this is happening, Kalor, why don't you roll athletics to keep up with this thing? And Talora, you get three strain back.
First.
I'm going to spend a story point, because why not?
And I will spend a story point right back.
All right.
Why not? I'll roll athletics right now.
Ooh.
Well.
In your haste, you try and chase after this thing. The way it moves, it can effectively just bypass obstacles really easily. You follow it out onto... one of the bridges that leads out of this larger chamber that you you and your allies were in, and as you're running, everything goes dark very quickly. You can no longer see, and soon enough, it's very kind of awkward and embarrassing, but you do full-on sprint slam into some piece of giant tech that is standing in your way, and it blurs your vision just a little bit. You fall to the ground and take a moment to get up and right yourself again, and at that point you are too disoriented to really see where this thing went.
Great. I'm just going to keep on walking in the direction that I was going in the hopes that I will catch sight of it again.
Sounds good. Yeah, actually, as you move forward, sort of feeling around at this point, you can sort of feel your way inside a doorway, and you can see that there's a few, a very small amount of lights on a sort of console-looking device similar to the ones that you and Talora saw earlier. It looks like there's one in here that has some sort of functional power.
Let's play with it.
All right, give me a... yeah, give me just a computer's role or mechanics role to see how well you interface with this thing.
Because of the shard, would I get any bonuses? Because
of the shard.
I understand.
Let's say yes. I'll give you a blue for this.
Nice.
Going to give you some setback, though, because it is technology that is ancient and unfamiliar to you.
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right.
However.
Okay. So you effectively managed to get this thing back online and access part of its systems. Unfortunately, it just takes a very long time. It takes a lot of your mental energy to sort of focus up and get through this thing. So meanwhile, Miles and Talora, you're there with Sunny, who appears to be stable, but not particularly responsive to much else. And your Aquarian friend just... ran off after that bizarre yellow light entity. So what are you both doing?
Can I actually use a story point to have our Krogan follow the VI too?
Ooh.
See if since she's stealthed and everything, maybe she can make it and follow it.
Interesting. Yes, that sounds great. Go ahead and spend that story point. Mm-hmm. And I'll roll some athletics for Erda. Let's see how this goes. Da 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 da. You just hear stomping footsteps. Boop, boop, boop,
boop. I'm sneaky. Bum, bum, bum.
All right. So let's see. Is this how this works? Yeah. Sure. This is how this works. Boop. Oh no.
Oh man.
Unfortunately, Erda.
Wow.
Quite simply disappears. You don't know if she fell into a trap hole, if she just went the wrong way, if she...
What is up with this difficulty?
Disintegrate. Oh yeah, that's way too high. What the heck? Oh, it was doubling up. Thank you for pointing that out, because that would be why. Let me roll it again and do it correctly this time. There we go. Same result, though.
But now there's no...
Oh, what the hell, man? Can you learn how to roll, please? Let's try this one more time. There we go. Still.
It's always the same.
Still the same result.
Erda!
Three rolls to get it right, but Erda,
technically, it's been getting better this whole time.
Yes, everyone is getting better, but it's still not good enough.
Yeah, there's been less threat, but
we
in
tried.
This game, failure does not stack. Like, one failure is full failure, so it's just very similar. Oh, Erda.
She tried.
We miss you, yep. Forta. We love you, Forta. All right.
It's true.
Yes, come back. We need you to roll.
Don't have me rolling. I just get it wrong and bad.
Forta has a calming presence that I really appreciate.
All right. Back to you, Miles and Talora. What are you talking about? What are you doing right now?
Well, Talora will try to get more information out of, what's her name?
Stani. She is unresponsive right now. She's barely conscious and doesn't seem able to articulate thoughts at this moment.
Did her suit record anything of what she saw?
Hers didn't, because no, Erda was recording some stuff.
Yeah, I was just wondering if, because, you know, if the VI, like, basically downloaded memories into her, I don't know if, you know, that would show up on, like, some of her instruments. Don't know the right word. But, she would definitely turn to Miles and say, you know what, we should probably try and find Kalor, because who knows what he's going to run into in here, or if he's going to touch something that he's not supposed to be touching.
If he ran off, who knows if that's the right direction. I need you to tell me what the right direction is.
I have absolutely no clue what the right direction is. So let's go carefully, and I will keep my eyes out to see if we can find the right direction. I need some more clues. I need some more information. I need to see more.
Well, let's go then.
I'll
take her. And right. I'll pick up our companion.
Okay.
All right. Can I roll some more knowledge,
yes,
to see, you know,
absolutely.
If
roll
I, you know,
either knowledge or the other one, archaeology, and you get a free upgrade thanks to your triumph earlier.
All right.
Thank you again, Paladin, for pointing out the weird rolling stuff. It is so easy for me to not keep track of that and just look at the results.
I'm here to help.
Thank you. All right, Talora. Talora, you kind of go into a little bit of history nerd for a little bit. As you're looking around, you quickly sort of get the idea from the tech that you're seeing around you and the way this place is laid out. This is a typical, not typical, this is a... in a similar vein to protein ruins that you've seen that have acted as what some have theorized to be research sites of some description. You notice that everything here is extremely Spartan, very pragmatic in how it is built, and that kind of coincides with the type of protein architecture you see a lot in their most late stage of construction. So you know that this is effectively late era Protheans that you are familiar with. You also notice that there are details here that are a little bit unusual. You see sort of these structures that could be statues, they could be communication devices, they could be refrigerators, for all you know. But they do not sort of condone to the typical Prothean architecture that you're used to. And you do know that Prothean society was built up of a lot of subjugated nations, so there is a chance that, you know, it could just be a bit of that influence, but it is just something, you know, interesting of note that you see here. Thanks to your ability to figure this place out, as it were, and really kind of put yourself into the history of it, you manage to navigate it fairly easily. You get the impression there is basically a singular control hub from which there are different laboratories, research places, who knows what, you believe that if what you're looking for is not in the hub itself, it will be at wherever would be used to draw the most power. And that is not something you necessarily know off the bat, but you could, once you get there, you could potentially find clues that will help you along.
Well, yeah, since the power is not on, we wouldn't know what draws too much power. And now that I have like this inner map in my brain, the way that Kalor ran, which direction is that? Is he running towards the hub?
Yes, he did. It is right. Effectively the only way out of this sort of smaller structure that you find yourselves in that isn't back into the mines again.
All right, so we're in a, so basically what Miles would see is just her muttering to herself a lot really fast, like, okay, and this might be late, very Spartan. I'm not sure what this influence is. Might be subjugated species. However, this is research, totally research. We're the main hub. Yeah, I think the only way out here is the main hub. I'm guessing we need the place with the most power. Yeah, we're going this way.
Okay. And I'll try to move as quickly as I can, considering I'm carrying a person, and also I got shot in the leg not too long ago.
You're really enduring a lot right now, Miles. great. Yeah, you make your way sort of across the bridge, and Talora and Miles, as you both kind of like activate the bright lights of your Omnitools to sort of shed some light. It's hard for you to tell, but around you there seems to be a lot of just empty space. Suggesting that you don't necessarily know how far one might fall if they were to fall off a bridge like this. But you continue on, and you are met with the sight of Kalor, who is both pressing a bunch of different buttons and touching a bunch of different things, trying to get something to work. And as soon as you get near him, you kind of hear him shout, "Yes!" As this console reacts to your interface, Kalor, and you can see that it, while you don't necessarily have any foundation for strange symbols that you're seeing, you can definitely start playing around to see, like, okay, what does this do? Let's get some information here.
Yeah, when Talora, you know, sees that, she's probably going to yell at him, "Stop touching shit! You have no clue what you're doing! Can you wait for me?"
I have some clue, and it's working just fine, thank you very much.
And what are you going to set loose on us this time? Let's do this together.
Well, I was
left
thinking...
something behind, by the way. I'll stick her like next to the console. Mm-hmm. She's not doing so hot.
Well, I was thinking, you know, wait, where's Erda?
Erda came to follow you, as far as I can tell from the footsteps, but now we have no clue where Erda is.
Might have gotten lost considering how quickly you ran away from her. All
or
of us.
Fell off the bridge I almost fell off of.
Yeah, that wasn't very smart either.
Anyway, I'm going to go through this and see what...
Can I try and help him? Like, do I know any of those symbols? Or figure them out?
Like, you recognize the Prothean, like, glyphs of the Prothean language. And, you know, with a very quick sort of tinkering around, both of you manage to activate something that generates this sort of green wisp before your eyes. And you can see that some sort of corrupted virtual intelligence-like being appears. It has a little bit of garbled speech to it. But it says to you, "Warning, critically low power. Warning, significant degradation of base systems. Warning, presence of unknown entities. Please identify yourselves."
What was that, what was that researcher's name?
The researcher's name was, Arzia Vriss.
I give the name Arzia Vriss.
I love
a
this.
A lie!
Please roll deception.
Of course I will.
Can I assist in that?
How?
I'm like, attending to our
like saying, "Sir, why are you giving him your real name? It's degraded."
Okay.
You don't even know if it understands.
Love it. Yes, go ahead and roll that. Cool.
And I'm going to use a player story point to upgrade this because okay. I feel like this needs to work.
All right.
I'm not ashamed of using story points. Never
we have noticed.
Oh, this is amazing. Okay, so that's a success and a lot of threat that's been generated as well. I love it. So you hear this holographic being speak, and it says it basically takes a long moment as though it is processing what you just said. And eventually it says, "Sensory system must be severely damaged. You do not read as head researcher Arzia Vriss."
That's unfortunate considering I am.
"Would you like to override the system?"
"Yes."
"Overriding commencing." And after a few seconds, there's no immediate change, but you can see that, like, this thing is struggling to kind of, like, run its basic functions. And there is a slight crackle and zap that comes from the console. does not seem good at all. A little bit of smoke billows out as well. You get the impression that this VI's time on this Earth is, or this planet, is very limited. There's potentially only so much it will be able to communicate with you.
All right. The first thing I'm going to say is shut off all project data collection.
Data collection is currently not functional. All power went to reserve systems.
What is functional?
Currently functional is the Anamnesis Research Lab is the only place with power.
Which direction is that? Again.
The VI takes like a second to just process what? before responding to you very diligently. And it says, located on the northwestern pathway. Query. Why do you not speak with the creator's language?
I'm testing your translation routines.
Understood.
Is there any other form of auxiliary power we can use to activate, that we can use to power up the rest of the station?
Extension of the lightning rods is possible. However, such a task requires highest level clearance from you.
Granted. Extend lightning rods.
Confirm. You want to extend the lightning rods?
Yes.
Commencing rod extension. And there is just a just utter quiet where you are. Nothing really happens. And then suddenly there is light that shines in this place. There are some horrible mechanical churning sounds as devices that have not been powered for some time suddenly get flooded with power. Some of them just straight up explode. Some of them just kind of power down immediately. But some of these technological things around you, these various devices in the walls and on the ceilings and such, hum with some kind of function.
I thought we were turning things off. This looks like the opposite.
Would you like to restore power to all research projects?
Without activating them? Is that possible?
Power can be given to the various systems within each hub.
Yes.
Activating. And at that point, the console in front of you fizzles a little bit more, some more smoke billows, some more parts of it just clunk onto the ground. But fortunately, since you've restored power to this place, you get the feeling like, oh, you don't need this specific console to do things necessarily.
Is the VI still there?
Yes, it is. It's basically just a big glitchy mess before your eyes right now.
Yeah, because I wanted to ask it if it could locate intruders.
Yeah, it says,
I just didn't want to interrupt you guys.
Reading scans of multiple unknown entities.
Alright, place on the map.
Alright, and with that it creates basically a hologram before all of you that is very distorted. It's not the most helpful in the world, but it gets a series of dots on it pinpointing various points of interest. You can see that the ruins themselves are filled with various dots in different places. Some of them are quite distinct. There are some that are like very clear, simple red dots. You can see where you are at. You are also reading as these little red dots. And there are some that are reading as sort of these more bluish dots everywhere as well. The other place that you notice red dots, there are a couple scattered here and there. But there's a decent convergence of them in one of the research wings.
highlight latest movement.
It says, unable to track latest movement. Scanners were offline.
I hold forward and activate my Omni tool. Send all misfiring and non-working systems. Send a list to this device.
Beginning diagnostic. And soon there's a moment where, first of all, the console in front of you explodes, gets completely obliterated. A few things
I'll
here
try
and
to
there.
Shield our friend.
Very good, yeah. You try and shield from the little bits of flecks of sparks and metal debris as well. With the destruction of that console, this hologram graphic entity before you disappears and very quickly reappears, much sleeker and smoother from another console nearby, though still a little bit distorted. And it says, beginning diagnostic. And it kind of looks at the console that's got destroyed, adding to the list. and it says, interfacing with new technology as it begins to try and find a way to interact with your Omnitool. And it takes a little bit, but soon enough you start to see some data sent there.
Excellent. Finally, we'll head off to the research. We're going to head off to the research station that did have power before we turned power back on.
Is that the same one where the dots were, or was that one a different one?
It is the same one, yes. I mean, there's some dots all over the place, but the most is in that place.
We love that. I pull out the data shard. This seems to be malfunctioning. Can you make it easier to access the information located inside?
Scanning. Appears to be functioning as intended.
Strange. Can I access you from any of the research hubs?
Correct. I am the analytical assistant in this place, ready to answer any questions that you need.
Is there a medical wing on? Where is the medical wing on site?
Medical wing is located in the northwestern hub.
Same hub as the research.
Warning. Records show depletion of resources.
Makes sense. Thank you. We should be off.
Would Talora know anything about these shards and how they work?
Yeah, go ahead and roll another archaeology or knowledge, and we'll do another upgrade thanks to your triumph earlier. Ooh. You know, it's right at the back of you. It's on the tip of your tongue. You know something about these, and you just can't quite remember it. I'm going to say that with that much advantage, you will remember at some point coming up very soon. But right now, it is completely escaping you.
It's like, yay. I know something about this. I cannot remember. It will come to me. It will come to me.
Yeah, well, right now, we have to focus on getting this... whatever's happening.
The
and we
creature.
Haven't found her brother yet either. He's hiding somewhere here. Order is somewhere. We have absolutely no clue what happened here. Let's
Instead
proceed
of
with caution.
Off all the bullshit the that's been happening, you turned more shit on.
Yeah, but he's in control now.
Is he?
Yes.
Mostly.
For now.
Would you like a rundown of current research projects and progress?
Send that to the same device you sent the diagnostics to.
Affirmative.
Yes, please share that with me.
I will, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We need to get going. The longer that research project is up and running, the more damage it's going to cause.
Well, send it to me on
the
way.
To that system.
So that I can be prepared and see, you know, if there's anything I need to know to keep us safe.
Yeah, I start walking and I start sending the files to everyone.
Okay.
Including Erdos. If Erdos Omni tools in range...
Yes.
Just a bunch of information's coming up.
Like,
sounds good.
I'm busy. No, I don't want to read this shit. Stop.
Do any of you take a look at this, or is that going to be like late night reading you're going to be doing?
I take a look at it.
I'm too busy carrying Aquarian.
That's fair.
Yeah. Talora is like just scrolling through it, seeing if anything catches her eye.
There are basically updates, like concise updates that are part of this report that have been translated into languages that you understand, fortunately. Effectively, let's see, what's the most pertinent information? There's a lot of data corruption as well, so there's not necessarily the full range of information that they can give you here. But you learn that this was effectively a weapons testing facility of some kind for the Protheans. And they attempted to create non-conventional weaponry. Supposedly inspired by tactics of their own empire being decapitated, effectively. They wanted to figure out something that could do something similar to their enemies. You see a lot of research for viruses, very complex sort of like quantum computing viruses. Ultimately, a lot of the most recent updates, just a list of more and more failures that the technology they're going up against is simply too difficult to overcome. You see there's a research project involving nanobots, and you see that like the most recent thing on there was that they managed to make it sort of hard-coded into the nanobots to prevent any kind of hacking or turning against them, but they had the potential at this stage to desolate an entire planet if unleashed and not properly regulated. You learn about something called the Mass Pulse Anchor, which is a device that is designed to be inserted into an enemy ship. It seeks out enemy power sources and uses them to increase its mass to debilitating levels, so it effectively becomes a gravity well slash gigantic wrecking ball within the enemy ship itself. And you learn that there is basically the most recent thing is shielding it from counter enemy software and trying to perfect its energy consumption, which is apparently too irregular to be effective currently. And you also learn about a project called the Anamnesis, which is the ability to forcefully extract intel from enemies, particularly strategy plans, exploitable weaknesses, and technological insights.
Can she tell which of these is going on in the research left we're heading to?
You're going to the Anamnesis project place. And you can see that in its most recent update notes, there's a lot of warnings of potential backfire, but also some excited insights into the progress that has been made with it as well.
Yeah. So I'm thinking that while she's like scrolling through and stumbling all over shit because she's not paying attention, she'll just babble, and then every time something exciting happens, she'll speak up and cheer and then look back down and, you know, trip over the next thing.
Clonk, clonk, clank. Yeah, it's a decent way for you to walk anyway, so it's enough time for you to kind of quickly discuss your findings as well.
All right, and have we turned that shit off? I don't want to get my brain extracted.
All right.
We're going to try.
By all means, go right ahead. You know, we've got some time before we get there.
Whose brain are we extracting? She was not paying attention. What? No, we don't have a station to extract brains safely. And she goes back to reading.
God damn it. I'm gonna pause, put her down, and try to do it myself. From my Omni tool.
Alright. So what exactly are you doing?
All power that is going towards that research lab stops.
Okay. Unfortunately, you have the data on your Omni tool, but no access points to the functions of this place.
Yeah, I'm just gonna try and then fail, I guess.
Look, don't rush it. Once we get there, we'll solve everything. Hopefully.
It's going to be a lot easier to figure stuff out if it's off and unable to hurt us.
Not really. Because if it's off, we don't have access to any of the data.
Uh-huh. We go there, we shoot everything that wants to shoot us, And when everything is peaceful and calm, we power up every kind of bit that we want individually.
It might just restart the whole shooting process. Don't worry, we'll solve it. It'll be fine. Hopefully. Maybe.
I have very little confidence as I pick up our injured friend.
Okay. As you make your way across the long bridge towards this research hub, you see that there are more of those ghostly entities lingering on the bridge as well. Some of them screaming in terror. Some of them quietly sort of weeping to themselves. Just bits and pieces of people's past, like little vignettes that you're just like slowly passing along the way. You can see things like somebody weeping near a hospital bed. You can see somebody executing somebody who is very close to them. You can see somebody like crashing a sky car into a bunch of pedestrians drunkenly. All sorts of horrific scenes that play out in front of you. But there's also the occasional, not terribly depressing, upsetting echo that you see as well. You can see that there's like a couple who are staring very longly at a sunset. You can see that there's a Krogan who is tearing up at the sight of their child. A group of soldiers sort of toasting the alliance and like celebrating a victory. All sorts of different things, and they're getting more and more dense the further you go. And with that, we're going to take a break, everybody. So thank you for joining us. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back very soon to see what is going on in this place. We'll be right back. See you soon. And we're back, everybody. Welcome back to Mass Effect. Where we just left off, the squad was going to head to an ancient Prothean research site where apparently there is something there that is capable of forcefully extracting an entity's memories. So,
as well as a host of other experimental weapons that are incredibly dangerous. Indeed. And they're all on. Yeah.
Planet destroying and virus civilization killing.
Yep.
A lot of bad stuff.
Everything's fine.
Good news though, there's a medical wing that's out of medicine. So, you know, there's that.
You gotta take what you can get sometimes. So, you are heading towards this region where you have been told by this this research station's VI that there was a project that was effectively prioritized to be kept up and running all this time. And now you have provided power back to the rest of the base, so it's fairly easy for you to traverse, and you are passing a lot, high density of these mix of horrific and sometimes somewhat quite sweet echoes of people's previous experiences, their moments of extreme horror, fear, trauma, elation, all sorts of things. So, you make your way to the hub. A massive door opens up before your eyes, revealing a fairly cramped interior that is stretching out quite a long ways. You can see there is a lot of bizarre alien technology sort of across the sides of this room, making the middle basically the only place where there's any room to maneuver around. And you can see this kind of stretches on and on and on a ways. One of the most notable things in this room is that there is a series of like these semicircular metal plates that are suspended in the air and spinning around. And within that, they're sort of making this like almost cage. Within that, there are some floating shards within that are somewhat reminiscent of the ones that the one that you picked up earlier, Kalor. You can also see that in this room there are bodies. People lying down. You can recognize people who are wearing IMC mining uniforms. Every now and then you can see one of them twitches and moves slightly. The rest seem stone still. It's about six or so that you can immediately see in this place.
So can Talora carefully check what's wrong with them?
Absolutely. Go ahead and roll a medicine. Careful.
And can I take a look at those other shards?
Yes, you can.
It's like, Talora is distracted. Elshie would tell you not to keep touching shit.
I didn't say I touched them. I'd say I look at them, compare them to mine, see if they're on, if they're more willing to transfer information.
Yeah, you're totally touching shit.
I'm standing next to Talora, still holding our friend, and I'm holding my gun to shoot the person she's checking, you know, okay. Just in case.
Okay, got it. Talora, yeah, you do an examination of the people here. The majority of them are dead. You can see that, as far as you can tell, given your limited resources and time available to you, some of them have died from dehydration, would be your guess. The others are there. Some are still alive, just incredibly either physically weak or mentally just refusing to move from where they are. Kind of like rocking back and forth a little bit. To your response, there is one human in particular who recoils in shock from you and just kind of like scrambles a little bit, wide-eyed and terrified, and starts trying to run away from you.
I'll order him to stop with coercion.
Okay, excellent. Let's see.
I leveled it for a reason, so.
I'm going to give a setback because they're not being reasonable right now, but a boost because you got a gun in their face.
That makes
sense to me. So go ahead and roll that. Yeah. All right. They start scrambling and moving around and being very erratic.
Stop or I'll shoot you.
And they stop.
There we go. Now get back here and let the doctor look at you.
And they, with much trepidation, slowly move towards you, Talora. And you can see kind of like through the visor of the helmet covering their eyes The eyes are very wide, very bloodshot. They seem to be in truly terrible condition. It is as though, you know, not surprisingly, they have gone through some horrible traumatic event and are suffering through some kind of PTSD right now.
Considering, like, most of them died of dehydration, I'll offer my water can to this person. Like, here, have some water.
They look at you with fear and kind of, like, mumble something, but do not reach out to grab what you offer.
It's just water.
He's not going to listen to you. Too traumatized.
Yep.
All right,
so, if I check him over, and I don't know if I have anything to sedate him with.
I think at this point, you don't necessarily have a whole lot of medical supplies on your person.
Yeah.
But you could, you know, direct them to a way out of this place or whatever you would like.
Would definitely say, I forgot his name. The research dude. The one that we maybe got killed, who was in charge of me.
Oh, Dr. Lewis, yes.
So I would say, Dr. Lewis sent us, and it's time for you to make your way out of here. We'll take care of this. Is there anybody else alive?
You kind of look at you. You can see that they're sort of getting every other word that you're saying a little bit, but they slowly sort of nod their head in acknowledgement. As to the, is anybody else alive, they sort of just, you know, look around them a lot and just shrug.
All right, so can I use my Omni tool to bring up the map of the place and show him where to go?
Yeah, absolutely. You're not entirely sure how much they're absorbing it necessarily, but it's better than nothing.
It's better than saying turn left, turn right, right. And at the busted console, you're almost there, you know.
So while this is happening, Kalor, you're going up to sort of the rotating semicircles which house these data shards. As far as you can tell, the like rotation of these semicircular bits of metal around like aren't—they're a bit of an obstacle. But if you wanted to, you could like time it and like reach in and grab on real quick, or you could look for a way to shut them down, or kind of like consult the VI who thinks you run this place. How do you proceed?
Yeah, I'm going to consult the VI.
Okay. They appear there, and they say, how might I be of assistance?
There's still power going to these, right? Correct. Was that continued on, even while power was mostly unavailable to the rest of the station, or?
Negative. These were offline for a very long time.
Right. Who did they belong to? As you said, it's been a very long time.
They belong to the creators, of course. Do you wish a review of their function?
Yes, I do.
The VI says, according to records, many of which have been corrupted, trying to compartmentalize and reestablish. According to records, I'm able to salvage. These data shards were used to contain information gathered by Project Anamnethis.
What was the function of Project Anamnethis?
Project A. I can't say that either.
The purpose of the project was to extract information from enemies who couldn't be gotten close to. It was to examine the moments of both organic and non-organic form and begin rapidly analyzing what was found. By probing particularly dominant memories, Anamnesis could synchronize the data at exponential speeds by creating facsimiles of the pertinent events, replicating sensory and emotional data, which in turn grants Anamnesis greater to full access of the subject's memories. These are then copied and sent back to Anamnesis Data Core, ready to be reviewed.
And all of that data was stored in these. These are the memories of people, of organic and non-organic beings.
Organic and non-organic. This is not the data core. This is merely where some of those memories were going to be transferred.
I pull out the one that I'd taken before, and this one? What was this one supposed to be storing?
That is a memory shard. It is used to transcribe experiences between one creator and another.
What experiences did this one contain?
It looks at it for a second, and it says, much of the research data here, as well as some tactical prowess.
I access this memory shard, but I don't seem to have access to the data itself. Is there anything that could unlock it?
As long as you have creator physiology, you should be able to interface it with it seamlessly.
Can I adapt this to be used with other physiology?
One moment. Such technology is believed to exist, although not at this site.
All right. Thank you.
It almost seems to regard you quizzically at you thanking it.
How long have you been offline for?
Obtaining data. Approximately 50,000 years.
Can you connect with other creator sites?
Negative. All communication at this research base was meant to be contained.
So you have no idea what happened to the vast majority of creators?
Correct.
Thank you. Again.
Just another, slightly quizzical look from this thing.
Well, that explains why accessing this was difficult. But I assume these ones are different. So if I touch one of these shards...
Yeah?
Nothing bad will happen, right?
Do you want to reach out and grab one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. You wait for these sort of floating discs to give you an opportunity, then you just reach in, grab one of the larger data shards, and I'm going to need you to roll... what did I say last time? Resilience?
Yeah.
Please roll resilience. I'm going to spend a story point to make this harder.
I'm going to make spend a story point and make this easier, because last time did not end so well.
All right. Sounds good.
One, two, three. Let's do it. Okay. Ooh, no, that's bad.
You all watch as Kalor reaches out to grab one of those things. He suddenly yelps out in pain and confusion, kind of grabs the side of his helmet and visor, and collapses onto the ground. And you're going
to
take...
I told him not to touch
he's
shit.
Not very smart.
You're going to take 3 points of strain.
3 points? I'm knocked out. Wait, no, I'm not. I've got 2 points of strain left.
And once
so
again,
Tamora will make her way over there and see if she can help him. Because very clearly, he cannot listen to me.
No, I'm fine. It was just...
You look, have sometimes you... a hell of a migraine right now.
Sometimes you just gotta try something to see if it works.
I don't think this is that time, buddy.
Are you 5 years old? Do not touch. Keep your hands to yourself.
Experimental weapons lab.
If all Corians did that, we wouldn't have created the Geth.
Because that is an amazing accomplishment.
Yeah, good Listen, job there.
Do not touch.
Well done.
Relax, Talora. I put the shard back where it belongs.
Okay. It just.
It's like you do that again, I'm going to smack your hands away. Okay. Like you are 5 years old. Well, you're acting like you're 5 years old.
These things are not meant to They're not meant for my physiology. They're meant for Prothean physiology.
Really? You don't want to grab another one just to make sure?
Well, if you insist, and I grab it.
what is the Mass Effect version of No Shit, Sherlock?
Oh, I don't know. Well, I'm going to need the exact same roll again, please, and I'll use a story point again against you.
Why not? We'll both use a story point. It'll be fine. I've now had experience with 3 of these. Can I get a boost?
No.
Nope.
Jumping off a cliff does not make your legs stronger. It just breaks
Holy
your legs.
Fuck.
All right. So this time you actually get some scattered images here and there. A flood of completely useless, garbage information that floods your brain and completely overloads it even. So you're going to take 4 points of strain, which is going to put you over your max, which means you are now incapacitated. I'll let you decide exactly what form that takes. But during this time, you are basically 2001 Space Odysseying through so many memories, you don't have enough time to really comprehend them, but there's something there.
I'm going to focus most on language.
Interesting.
Whatever snippets of language I can try and understand.
Okay. The rest of you just see as soon as Kello touches this, it is like he just like grabs an exposed wire. He just like vibrates and collapses onto the ground.
Worth it. So worth it.
Thor goes over and checks on him, and when she sees, you know, he's not really hurt, he's just, you know, she's just gonna gip slap him. Like, I told you not to freaking touch!
Just let him lie there. Can you access his systems and turn off all the devices now?
I mean,
we have enough experience to see that they're bad?
Because I know he wanted to turn on only the power. He didn't actually start up the research again. So we only have like lights and air and stuff. Yeah. None of the research things are turned on.
You basically have all life support. Computers, consoles, stuff like that, life support. Like the doors work and things like that. Heating is now back on. And all the tools and devices and consoles now function as well, but none of them are doing anything unless they have specific protocols to do so.
It's only the one research project that was sucking up all the energy that's still on.
Correct.
See, I thought this through.
Yeah, totally. Professional. Please really, go goad him into touching more shit, please.
At this point,
he's unconscious now. That's done.
He's not quite unconscious. He's just severely mind impaired, shall we say? Yeah. Although,
does it look
arguably,
like he's in pain?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll just knock him out then.
What?
And
it's not hard.
No. Bunk. I'm a very compassionate individual, and I hate to watch people in pain.
You hear
also, he's annoying.
The sound of Sani actually stirring a little bit as she awakens to the sight of Miles just clonking her only other Quarrigan ally unconscious in this moment. And she just goes, what?
Perfect.
What happened?
He touched too much stuff. Welcome back.
I had a terrible...
You were pretty hurt.
And she kind of looks down and sees the wound that has been patched closed. And she just goes, oh, bullshit.
Yeah, sorry, infection incoming. But at least you're back with us. We have not found your brother yet. However, somebody has been touching all the shit and needed a nap like a 5-year-old.
Yeah.
Worth it.
What is this place? Where are we?
It's an experimental weapons lab.
Yeah, research facility, late Prothean.
Oh. Okay, well... I'm gonna find my brother, and she like struggles to her feet a little
bit. Hold up, take it easy.
Yeah, you're sticking with us.
Maybe you can watch over him while we go deal with stuff.
Yeah, you want to get knocked out by some more crazy geth?
No.
We're pretty sure we know where your brother is. If he's not in this pile of corpses, and I'll show around. Yeah. I don't think he is. You know.
Yeah. She kind of has only just really acknowledged the corpses at this point. And looks around and goes, and doesn't seem to.
We would have seen a Quarian.
Yeah, she doesn't see her noticed. Brother there. So she
that
says,
means he's over there. But there's a lot of dangerous stuff over there.
What happened to us? Why were there geth? Are there geth here?
I guess it's one of those experimental weapons.
That's terrifying.
Yeah, at first I thought it was a memory of somebody because they were fighting each other. But then, you know, they had enough corporality. I don't know what the hell it is. To actually attack. Might have been a security feature or a weaponized memory.
If there are geth here, we need to find my brother and leave as soon as possible.
I doubt there's actual geth.
Then what attacked us?
Well, it wasn't a real geth. It was just some bullshit projection that you know, Prothean stuff made real enough to actually hurt people.
To me, it seems.
Hopefully, it's off, but.
To me, it seems real as day. It's something I've gone through before. It was like it was happening all over again, except slightly different, because I didn't get shot last time.
Well, you've actually been through that?
It's where I saw my parents die before my eyes.
Did you recognize them in your vision?
Yes.
Well, there you go. It tried to kill you with your own memories. Happy Prothean Day or whatever. All right, let's go in there and shut this thing down.
I'll watch over Kalor.
And be careful. If he wakes up, he's going to want to touch everything.
All right. So you and Talora proceed further into the space. Kalor, you soon sort of... Your faculties are still a bit all over the place, but she at least like tries to stir you from your unconsciousness. And the entire time you were unconscious, your mind was still effectively in free fall, doing kind of going through a full trip. And it's no different when you wake up. It's just now you have to deal with the pain of sensing reality as well. But you see Sani above you, and you two appear to be alone here.
I immediately, like, grab her into a half hug. Oh, thank goodness you're alright.
Are you okay?
Oh yeah, I'm fine. Who knocked me unconscious?
The human did.
The human? You ever noticed that they're not as risky as us?
Not really, no. She kind of like, well, actually, she looks down at her wound and goes, maybe there's something to that, I don't know.
Yeah, Delora, walk up again and we'll give him another gip slap.
No,
I said,
you and I have,
do not touch!
Delora, you've both left by this point.
Yeah, we've left. We've
the
gone to the place.
The spirit of Delora definitely does that.
Like, we've smack you again!
We've gone to the place.
This thing was designed to access your memories. Well, anyone's memories. It's a weapon. I've accessed some of them myself. Species that I didn't even recognize. Some of them weren't even organic. And they weren't Geth either.
I was just explaining to the others that what just happened back there has happened to me before, and it was like it's happening all over again.
They recreate facsimiles of your memories to try and access even more of them. In that heightened state of confusion and adrenaline, it makes it easier to see what you remember. It's a way of investigating what someone might be trying to hide.
Does that mean, did they get what I had in my memories?
Yes. And it's probably stored somewhere in that hub.
We have to go. We have to go right now. There's everything about the migrant feet, about our culture, everything.
It explains what happened to your brother. How did it get transmitted? I'm saying that as I'm like getting up, and I'm clearly not well at all.
Neither of you are. You're both holding each other up barely right now.
Hey, it's a Korean potato sack race. We need to make sure that the other two don't access that information. You haven't seen a Krogan, have you? Great. More confusion. How are you feeling now? Are you still lost in those memories?
It doesn't feel good right now. It's like I am scared of every little bit of shadow in this place, and I'm not somebody who's usually very scared of the dark.
Seems to happen to a human here too, and whoever else happens to be alive. It'll be fine. It's not real. At least I hope it's not real.
It feels pretty real.
Those weren't real Geth. They were formed out of kinetic barriers.
Strange. When I saw them, it was just as I remembered them.
Probably because it had access to your senses. Could add to the barriers that were already present to make something a bit more real looking. I'm sorry about your parents.
Thank you.
Never even got to know mine.
Wait, so you grew up without any parents?
You ever heard of the Kanan?
No.
It was, It was a small scouting vessel.
My mother was pregnant on it with my father. Father was pregnant on it. Unfortunately, due to an accident, a stray shot from a Geth ship hit the reactor. My mother was farthest away from it. She survived, but barely, and in space with a ruptured suit. When I was born, 2 months later, she was already gone. They'd kept her on life support just to... It's funny, I've survived 2 ship-destroying accidents in my life. And I always feel the need to own up to it, to become something worthy of all that sacrifice. But there really isn't anything, right? It's a never-ending battle. Anyway, keep moving.
Your mother sounds like a very tough person. I'm sure she loved you a lot.
Didn't get to know me. Who knows if she'd even recognize me. And then I was treated like a science experiment. Foreign biotics are rare, after all.
Oh. Maybe today we can find just a moment where we don't have to suffer any pain, where we can get some good news.
Your brother probably didn't do this on purpose. All that information going out there. He may have not realized what happened. If that's the case, we'll come up with a convincing lie for the fleet.
That would be neither of you equivalent to treason.
Neither of you deserve to be banned for this. No one does. And I think I just fall into silence as I slowly limp towards the rest.
Okay. So while that was happening, Talor and Miles, you are continuing through this research area, when you kind of emerge into each different section of this particular hub. Again, it's a lot of completely alien, unusual technology that you see around you. There's one of the most notable things that you see is a large sort of divot on the ground with this large beam of light that is coming out of it and going straight into the ceiling. It is difficult to ascertain what it does or what it is for, but it definitely seems important somehow. You also see that there are a couple more echoes in this place, some people and things. None of them seem to be aggressive, just more memories that have sort of scarred the landscape in this place. And why don't you both give me perception checks?
Also look on the map that we have to see if this is where the actual people are.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good. All right. So to Laura, you get a little bit distracted in your nerdiness, shall we say, of
yes.
What does this do? What is the function of this? And this as well. Oh, it's just a treasure trove of archaeological finds. Meanwhile, Miles, you have a little bit more of a pragmatic approach to these things. And when looking around, you basically notice something that you know is universally... valuable, which is some refined Ezo. It is extremely old. You don't necessarily have the know-how if such a thing can decay or get worse over time, but if you wanted to quickly grab some of that, you certainly could.
If I think I can do it safely, then yes.
We'll say with that much disadvantage you got, we'll say, yeah, you think it'll be fine.
Cool beans, okay.
Stop touching things, remember that?
I wouldn't, but, you know, the role. It's forcing me to collect money.
All right. And as you two are kind of looking around this place, you can see it kind of still extends into another area as well. But very soon, Miles, you notice that there is a figure standing very quietly in sort of the door that exits this place into the next area, who is almost completely silent were it not for your sort of enhanced soldier sense. And they are just standing there.
This is an actual person, I'm guessing?
Yeah, you look over. It's still a little bit obscured in a little bit of shadow. There's still, you know, some lights around here. But you can see that this is clearly a person. It is not any kind of echo. They appear to be hooded. Yeah, they're just kind of watching the two of you move around.
I check to see if Talora's still with me and is she not distracted by all the cool protein stuff that's all around.
She definitely got distracted by all the cool protein stuff and is in her own world right now.
Yeah, I'll radio her. Talora, come on, eyes front.
All right, front. Yeah, there's more stuff up front, definitely up front.
And I'll wait for her to rejoin.
Okay, you two reconvene. When you look back to the door, make another perception check. All right, you see a very brief flash, or rather, Miles, unfortunately, you see nothing. Talora, as he calls you over, you see a very brief flash of something moving in this doorway and then disappearing into the room beyond.
Did you see that? Something moved in that doorway and went down there.
Good. Well, let's go after it.
Let's be prepared.
It'd be dangerous, remember?
Yes, I remember.
Okay, so we'll do all the military moving where we stand like this against the door.
Yeah.
And do all the hand signs.
Excellent. You proceed through the doorway, moving carefully and cautiously as you do so. You hear a sort of loud, resounding beep coming from something nearby. And Miles and Talora, when you look down, you can see that there is some sort of device affixed to the side of this doorway that you just entered. And Miles, you can immediately recognize this is some kind of explosive device, not Prothean. This is, pretty standard military device here. Talora, mm-hmm. It probably doesn't take you too long to put two and two together that this beeping thing next to you is pretty bad.
I'll stop Talora and then I'll try to disarm the thing.
Okay, as you move to disarm it, you hear a voice come from further within this place that says, I wouldn't get much closer to that if I were you. Otherwise, it might just go off.
What was the brother's name?
His name was... Viaz. But this is a feminine voice that you're hearing right now.
Yeah.
Can I still roll
We're here for Viaz. Have you seen him?
Hold on. One at a time. So, Talora, you said what?
I'm going to call out and say, we're looking for Fiaz. Have you seen him? His sister's looking for him.
The voice yells back and says, just who are you two? Who are you two?
I'm a mechanic, and I'll do my demolitions roll to see if...
Heavily armed for a mechanic.
Oh, you know where you are?
Hey, Miles.
I think I accidentally detonate this explosive device.
So, Kalor, we're going to jump to you real quick. As you're moving through this place, you suddenly hear a resounding explosion coming very close nearby. You can even sort of feel a shockwave coming from it. Miles and Talora, you're both going to take... let's see.
Remember what I said about...
You're a center of an explosion. So I'm going
to say... Nobody's listening to the no touching, right?
So I'm gonna say you both take 30 points of damage. Boom.
Oh my!
Now, Talora, your soak does apply, so you can take -3 off that to only take 27.
Which then makes it 11 wounds. Which
Ouch.
Makes it 6. She's probably just gonna. She probably fell down while it happened, and she's gonna look at Miles, and she said, "I told y'all to stop touching shit."
And, you know, bits of tech around you completely explode as well. Bits and pieces fall down from the ceiling. This place is, you know, corroded and old, and there's not a lot sort of holding out here. A bit of paneling from the floor just falls straight out and, like, seems to fall into a dark abyss. And both your ears are ringing for a very, very long time. And you're quite badly hurt from the resulting explosion. Soon enough, the figure around the corner just kind of like stares at this entire debacle and just pulls her hood down. And you see that she's a Turian and she just goes, what did I just tell? Are you both alive still?
And she's like, Talora's like, they're just not listening. It's like, I brought these dudes and they cannot stop touching shit.
Okay, I don't care about your problems, Asari. Why don't you both turn around and leave this place before you hurt yourself anymore?
I spend whatever action I have to recover my shield.
Yes, fair enough. it takes a while because they got thoroughly hammered, but yes, you managed to restore your shields back to full again.
And Dolores is going to say, right now my problems are your problems because there's more of them out here still touching shit. Just like he touched shit he wasn't supposed to touch. And okay. She says, I'm Talora Tesus, by the way.
You newcomers to this place?
Huh?
You newcomers to this place?
Yes. Yes, we came here to find... I forgot his name again.
Vias.
Vias, have you seen a Quarian? And she's probably being loud because her ears are ringing. Yeah. So she's like, we're looking for that Quarian. His sister asked us to come. And then, you know, what was the researcher's name again? Also, Dr. Lewis assigned me for some research here.
She says, that's all great. Yeah, there's a Quarian. He's back there towards the end of the labs. He's a little bit shaken. So be careful of that. I'm going to leave now. And she starts walking towards both of you.
Wait, who the hell are you and why did you fucking bomb us?
She says, oh, that was just a little bit of insurance that could have, you know, this could have ended less explodey, but apparently that's not how we do things around here, so I'm just gonna leave. We can both part ways, maybe being a bit wiser for this encounter, so see you later.
We used all our story points, didn't we?
You currently have zero, yes, unfortunately.
Yes. Because I wanted to order to come and stop her, but I don't have no story points.
I mean, we're coming through the same entrance that she's exiting.
When you ask if she has a name, she looks to you, Miles, and she goes, sure do, and continues walking, going past all the destruction and debris. Does anybody stop her? Or do you allow her to pass?
I'll check with Talora, you know, the quick back and forth, like, do we shoot her, or...
and she's just like...
Okay, I'll walk through the door then.
Sounds good. Why don't you both also roll perception while we're here? And I will spend a story point on here for the sake of just giving you more story points if nothing else. Alright, so Talora.
Very clear. Talora is just so pissed off. It's like they're all acting like little kids who cannot stop touching. So she's like completely distracted.
She
told you not to touch it!
Alright, so yes, thank you, by the way, pal, for rolling your despair on disarming a bomb. Never did I think we would get such an opportunity. Yeah. Beautiful. Anyway, she managed to get a long way out of your sight. Well, not out of your sight. At the cusp of being out of your sight. Miles, for a very brief second, you look back just to make sure she's not going to do anything strange, stepping in the back or anything like that. And you notice that she basically pats something on a pack that she's carrying and kind of checks that it's still there, still okay. And you see something shining extremely brightly coming out of her pack before she quickly covers it up again. And then she disappears around the corner.
I think she took something valuable.
Sorry.
I'll tell Talora.
Or when are you going to message me? Or...
Well, at this point, Kalor...
I think you're unconscious, so...
At this point, Kalor, you and Sani, as you're both limping very slowly to reconvene with people, you see this Turian appear, and she kind of like looks at you both and goes, hello?
Is that your bomb?
She says, no.
You wouldn't happen to have anything in any medigel, would you? Were a bit worse for wear.
She says, oh wait, was there something happening while you were saying that?
And as I'm gonna like stumble up to her, okay, collapse in her arms and press that that semicircle data shard into her palm.
I believe you put it back, or is this the first one you got?
I didn't put it back. I never said I did.
Pretty sure you said you put it back.
Well, then this is the first one.
Okay.
he's grabbed three. So
that's fair. You have great
choices of plenty.
You've been very grabby. Why am I even disputing this? Okay. Yes. yeah. You stumble up to her and try and put this in her palm. Sounds great. Cool. She's gonna make a resilience check as her mind is invaded with a flood of memories that are not compatible with her physiology, so that's great. Let's see, what would this be? Da-da-da. Sorry, I have to pull up this. I did not expect this. Which I always love.
I'm so sorry.
No, this is the best kind of not expected. We'll be doing resilience, right?
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
All right. Probably more resilient than I am. Don't know why I'm bothering.
And I'm going to spend a story point again, just for the sake of evening the scales a bit. Alright, so, okay. As soon as you do that, you can see that her eyes suddenly go wide, and she looks down at what you're doing, and quickly attempts to snatch the data shard away from you, and then pushes you down as hard as she can, and she starts bolting.
I'm going to... Can I biotic punch her as she tries to try to escape?
Absolutely, you can. Let me set up the difficulty there. Alright. Ready when you are.
I feel like it's not fair to use a story point right now, but I'm going to anyway.
Well, okay. Here we go.
I just want to punch.
You've punched so many things this session so well. No, go for it. Let's see what you get. Oh, that's a critical hit, folks. Now, I believe your biotic punch has several interesting properties. If you look under your weapons tab, you can activate those freely with a triumph if you would like, or you can just do a critical hit, your choice.
It's a critical hit, or I could disorient her.
Correct.
Which adds J to all skill checks for one or knockdown. She's knocked prone.
Okay, you very quickly rev up a biotic punch, and as she is bolting away, you punch extremely hard to the point where, like, the biotic force extends and manages to catch up with her. She is thrown onto the ground, and you can see that a very bright orb rolls out of her pack onto the ground, and she looks at you with a smidgen of being impressed and also just being horror struck as well.
I mean, you could have not lied. I go to pick up the orb.
She shoots you with her shotgun.
Okay.
Kablam. Alright, you move up to her. As soon as you do, she whips out her shotgun. It quickly unfolds in her hands, and she fires it right into you, Kalor. So, let me just...
We're engaged.
Oh, that's true. That's very true, so that's going to be...
Congratulations!
Increased difficulty.
And thank you.
It is also technically 2 under weapons, that's going to be additional difficulty there as well. Where is her sheet? It's gone. Oh no. Here it is. Sorry, everybody.
It's going to be great.
So, kablam. Here we go. You are going to take 6 plus 2 is 8 points of damage as you are shot. And I'm going to say that little bit of threat is her picking up the thing again and getting ready to leave. Meanwhile, Miles and Atlora, reeling from everything that just transpired, you suddenly hear from behind you a shotgun blast go off.
All right. Looks like the plan to shoot her is back in effect.
All right.
I'll go in that direction.
Okay. Miles all retreats. Atlora, do you follow?
While we're doing that, can we regenerate some shields?
Yeah, at this point your shields are fully regenerated, but your health is still exactly where it stands, unfortunately.
All right, so can I try and slap some band-aids on myself while we're walking?
Yeah, you can.
Or is that too rough?
Do you still have some Medi-Gel? Or do you want just want to do a medicine check?
Yeah, I have 2 Medi-Gels, but I can still do it if do I have enough time to slap it on if I fail?
My
daughter is down here mad.
No worries. It's just the sound of somebody's echo going off in the background. That's all it is. So yeah, if you would like to restore instant 5 health, that can be done with Medi-Gel. If you would like to restore health, otherwise you can roll medicine.
I basically take out one of the Medi-Gels and throw it at Miles' head.
Well, I have my own. I'll use a Medi-Gel myself. Okay. That's fine.
And I'm going to roll medicine on myself and see what I can do before.
Sounds good. Let me just double check this. So currently your health is below half its threshold, so it's going to be a difficulty of 3 for medicine. So go ahead and roll when you're ready. All right, so you recover 2 wounds and 1 strain with that. Oh, sorry. Never mind. You recover 2 wounds and nothing else.
All right. And then I'm going to use one of my Medi-Gels on top of it. That's 5, right?
Yep, 5 health back. And the way healing works, or rather healing items work in Genesis, is that first time you use it, heals 5, second time heals 4, third time heals 3, and so on, until it is no longer effective, and the next day it is it has its full potency again.
Okay.
So I'm just going to put little markers on your sheet so we know you've already taken some Medigel for wounds. And with that, do you both start running back towards the Turian and towards your Quarian companions?
Yeah, yes. Because somebody is shooting. All blowing right. Shit up.
We'll say there'll be a one combat round that takes place before you two show up. So, Kalor, please roll Vigilance.
Love to.
And I need to change this character's name on their sheet so it doesn't reveal what their name is yet.
One success, 3 advantage. That should be high up in the round.
Let's roll for them as well. This would be Vigilance as well, because they were not expecting any of this. All right.
Oh, no. Come on.
For some reason, it didn't go on the turn tracker, which is a little bit annoying.
Oh, because you didn't roll initiative. You just rolled Vigilance.
Oh.
Initiative.
Blah. You're absolutely right. Thank you for that. Cool. So with that, first turn goes to the Turian. She quickly puts her hood back up, grabs the thing, and shoves it back inside her pack. And then she says, I don't know what your deal is, but if you follow me, I will obliterate you. She throws down something, and immediately the area fills with very dense smoke. So you are now both considered to be concealed, level 3, which is important for certain things. And that brings it to your turn, Kalor.
But we're still in the same range band, right?
You are still in the same range band, yes.
Okay, so she's got the orb thing under one hand, under one arm.
She kind of like shoved it back into her pack.
What would it take to rip her pack off her back?
A mighty athletics check. Or melee. Let's call it melee.
Can I use biotics?
if you would like to flavor a biotic strike as, you know, ripping the pack off, you could do that. It just wouldn't do damage to her. It would just apply it to her pack.
You're down to do that.
Okay, cool. So due to the concealment, you're going to get 3 setback dice to this. And I'll use a story point to make this harder for you.
And I'm going to use a story point to make it a bit easier because...
All right. So go ahead and roll your biotic melee whenever you're ready.
Yep.
Ooh. So unfortunately you don't manage to rip off her backpack, but you do kind of like just grope and grab at something, and we'll say that you get what could it even be? You get your own smoke grenade. So you can go ahead and add a smoke grenade to your inventory.
Love that.
Excellent.
I still have a maneuver left.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to aim.
Okay. Trying to coax any kind of shot through the smoke. Sounds good. All right. With that, new round, and your allies arrive. So let's get Talora and Miles' initiative, and we'll plop them in.
On Vigilance or Cool?
This will be Vigilance. That's a 3 for Miles. Nice work there. Be there. And Talora's Cool. Excellent. All right. So I don't remember what to do on ties if it is tied like this. I'm just going to roll a d2. 1 is Miles goes first. 2 is Turian goes first. So Turian goes first. So new round. The Turian quickly uses her maneuvers to... She uses one maneuver to run away further. And then she turns around and says, I don't have time for this. And there is a sudden bright light that sort of appears within the smoke that's very hard for you to really see what's going on. And then suddenly a being composed of these bright light shards sprints towards the 3 of you.
That's bad. So we recognize that.
Somebody to roll Discipline. Who's going to do it? Kalor, please roll Discipline. Let me just set difficulty.
Of course. I'd love to.
Sorry, I just said it first. Go ahead and do it now. Okay.
I'd love to.
You feel this entity slam into your psyche a little bit, and you hear it utter the words commencing interface, and suddenly it disappears from sight, and you can feel a presence in your mind, and you're going to take 2 points of strain damage.
I'm out again.
And you all see Kalor drop to the ground.
I did God succeed. Damn it.
I'm so sorry.
So that's nice.
You succeeded, yes. Your mind is strong. Your body has given up. All right, so that was Tyrion's turn. PC slot, who wants to go?
I will. What first, I'm going to use a story point Ooh. To have Erda fight the Tyrion.
Oh, yes. She it's like runs
I have
the
done
door
with this.
And
yes.
bounces off an invisible Krogan.
I want her to just
love it.
Ride into her as she's confidently skipping away.
Love that so much. That's great.
Yeah, I think that's going to be good.
Knockdown!
That's the story point button.
What do you want to bet this is the thing the Shadow Broker wants?
There it is.
to be cold, to be clotheslined by a Krogan?
Mm-hmm. That's what we all want. Alright. And for my own action, I'll move up with a maneuver, and then I'll shoot the light thing.
Shoot the light thing has disappeared from view. It disappeared as soon as it touched Kalor.
Oh, okay. Then I'll move 2 maneuvers up.
All right. Cool. With that, you are in the same range band as the Tyrion. Let me just roll. Let's see. Erda has a sharp baton. She's gonna just level that sharp baton at this Tyrion. It's gonna be. 2, and then concealment's gonna be 3. And here we go, Erda. Make us proud. Bam! Oh!
Come on!
Wait, did I roll that correctly? I did. That's all.
Can't possibly be right.
I don't know where the extra
4 setback failures?
Erda had stuff on her sheet. So let me undo that and try that again.
Oh! that's still not right. That's none of her abilities. And it's,
One more time.
It's still 3 setback dice.
Because I'm jumping between 2 different sheets. Here we go. Let's try it.
It's 3 setback.
There we go.
What? There's still 4 setback die now.
That's right.
Is that correct?
That is not correct. Why are there 4? Where's that 4th one coming from?
I don't know.
Does Erda have a critical injury I'm not aware of? She does not. I don't know where the 4th one's coming from.
She should get boost dice from attacking from stealth.
Hell yeah. So I don't know why this is doing this. I'm just going to reduce it by that and just give her another one. And we're going to make this the final roll this time and just see if it works. Bam.
That's
I'm just
better.
Stunned. What?
Because of advantage.
I'm not allowed to roll for Erda anymore because all I seem to roll... Now, granted, there was some dodgy dice stuff happening, but regardless, all I seem to roll is bad stuff. That is 2 advantage, though, so, what can we do with this? I'm so sorry that was so disappointing.
Maybe she successfully boxes the Tyrion in for the next round? No escaping?
Yeah, I like that. It's basically, glider box is too
yeah,
big.
Yeah, like, she charges at the Tyrion. The Tyrion, like, goes to flip her and ends up on top of Erda.
Beautiful.
But that still means she's engaged right. and pinned.
A little bit stuck. Love it. Excellent. Yeah. So yes, with that, Miles, what would you like your turn to be?
Well, I did 2 moves. That was my turn.
You did 2 moves. Excellent. All right, bring it to another PC slot. Kalor, you're currently very dazed. You're not unconscious, so you can still kind of do stuff, just not actions. Otherwise, Talora, it's down to you.
Can I, so to manipulate an object is a maneuver in of itself?
It's effectively too much beyond your level of incapacitatedness right now. So the most you can really do is kind of roll around, say things a little bit, but for the most part, you're kind of one of your health bars is gone effectively.
Is it possible to take further strain to my wounds instead?
If you would like, I like this.
I think I'm going to do that. I think I'm going to use my maneuver to get within 1 range band crawling on the floor for the Tyrion.
Okay.
And then I will take 2 wounds to drop the smoke bomb in her pack and turn it on.
Got it. Okay. Mm-hmm. I just want to clarify that your understanding of the situation is not different from mine. So let's clarify what I imagine will happen here. It seems like when you set that off, put it in her pack, moments later, the room will fill up with much more smoke, but originating from her pack, and it will still kind of affect everybody in this general area? Or is there something more different you're expecting?
I feel like it will damage her pack sufficiently enough that it can't hold the orb anymore.
Interesting. Okay, yeah, I buy that.
And she holds a two-handed shotgun, so...
Yeah.
She has choices to make now.
Let's do... Why don't you roll devilish?
Yeah, we can do that. We can roll demo.
I'm giving you 3 setback dice because you I'm actually going to give you 5 setback dice to this because you're in terrible condition and concealment everywhere. You can't even see her pack to grab it in the first place. So, with that, go ahead and roll when you're ready. This is great.
This is not going to work.
It might.
Let's try it anyway. No, it didn't.
You try to sort of reach out, grab the pack. You grab something. You're not sure what it is. And you shove the smoke bomb inside. And then you just yell Erda, go, hey, what was that? As something explodes in her pack.
Watch in my mouth!
It wasn't the mouth, fortunately. That would be truly terrible. But now there's more smoke everywhere. So it's just, you're all completely visually impaired because it is just thick gray smoke everywhere. You're probably coughing a little bit at this point. It is very hard to get any kind of indication of where what's going on or where. Great. So, Talora, what would you like to do?
All right. So how far is she away from me?
She is 1 range band away from you, so a maneuver's worth.
Okay, so that means she's within medium range?
Correct.
Okay. If I wanted to do cryoblast, will aiming help?
I'm going to say yes.
All right. Then, because she counts as vulnerable, right? Does she?
Her current state of shieldy /barriers is not 0, so she is not currently vulnerable, no.
Okay, so I can freeze her.
Once those are brought down, then she will be.
I did aim last round. I forgot to add the blue dot. Well, whatever.
A part of me feels like falling
whatever
unconscious.
Whatever I do next.
Okay, for sure. All right, so Talora, you want to cryoblast? Do you want to do something else?
Yes, I want to aim and I want to cryoblast her. Good.
All right, so it's going to be 3 setback because of the smoke, 1 boost because of the aiming you just did, and then cryoblast, what does that require exactly? Is that against the simple difficulty you said?
Yeah. Cool. Mechanics versus simple difficulty.
Go ahead and roll.
All right.
I will use a story point, so please roll again. Sorry.
Really, really, really? I like my roll.
I know.
I like
but you have a story point this time. There we go. All right.
It's still a good roll.
So with that, tell us what happens on a success with cryoblast.
I can freeze an enemy I can see within medium range, and the target takes additional damage from all sources equal to 1+1 per success.
Ooh.
And vulnerable targets freeze solid for the duration, but she is not vulnerable.
Yeah, so she's not frozen solid, but she is chilled right now, so all damage she takes will be increased by 2 until her next turn.
Yes, and now I have... What am I going to spend all my advantage on?
Can I point out that the roll actually got worse afterwards?
Oh, that red one?
Roll got worse? What do you mean?
Yeah, oh. I mean, it used to be a purple one, and now it's a red. Is that
because he used the story point?
Yeah, okay. The story point, it upgrades the difficulty.
It upgraded the difficulty.
Okay.
But again, thank you for remaining vigilant on those dice. Gotta keep them accurate.
I thought the story point went the other way, so my bad.
Goes both ways. All right, so I'm just gonna put the marker on you for a second, so I know that she's got ice.
How long is our turn gonna be? Was that the last one to act?
Sorry, what do you mean?
Oh, the current round. Are we at the beginning or at the end of the current round?
We're at
round?
The end of the current round.
Okay. Then I would like to use 3 of them to gain 1 defense until the end of my next turn. I am gonna use 1 to add a blue 1 to the next allies check.
Sounds good. All right, new round. The Turian is up. Let me just reconfigure where things are right now. So currently, there's a Krogan. She's interlocked with a Krogan. In some way. Another smoke grenade has gone off, making things just incredibly... Nobody can see anything. Kalor, you are basically prone next to her, although she probably doesn't regard you as much as a threat at this current time. And Miles, you were just a little bit ways back. Is that, no, you ran up next to her as well, didn't you? So there's a little bit of a dog pile going on here. Excellent. Cool. With that, you hear a very familiar sound as a stealth cloak gets engaged. It could be Erda, but it isn't.
Yeah, I don't think it's right.
With that, the Turian is basically going to, I'm going to say, just spends every action the turn just getting past this blockade and just creepily escaping through the smoke. I don't think there's really much else she can do given all the bad stuff happening at this moment. And at that moment, Kalor, your mind is at its breaking point right now. It's been a roller coaster of terrible things today. But you feel the intrusive presence in your mind is, through whatever miraculous means, it is repelled by you, or at least it finds nothing of particular worth there. You aren't really sure how it functions, but suddenly the entity appears just next to you again, Kalor, and it turns, and you don't really know how this thing perceives things, but Miles, it runs up to you and it says, commencing interface, and I need you to roll a discipline check.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no.
Miles, what is your most terrible, traumatic memory of your past that is also the most dangerous?
Oh, that'll be getting the wound then.
Okay, to the original time you first got the scar, the very nasty scar across your face.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, Miles, you feel a sudden unease, a bit of a headache, and then you are thrust back into those moments that you remember with perfect clarity. And as this is happening, the rest of you can kind of perceive throughout the smoke, maybe not really perceive that much, you can feel a change in energy of the air as a facsimile of something is being constructed around you, this time taking the frame of Miles's memory. Miles,
Turian and Alliance soldiers fighting.
Excellent. Okay, so there's
each
now
other, you know.
So there's now these echoes of Alliance soldiers and Turian soldiers in a very enclosed space, opening fire throughout all of this smoke. And Miles, you're going to take 3 strain.
That is bad.
Okay. PC turn. Who would like to go?
I'm going to call upon the VI.
Oh. I love that you take you can basically talk and basically kind of move, and that's about it. I love that you took those few options and turned into something very helpful. Love it. All right, what are you doing?
Let's wait to see what he does.
Commence full station lockdown. And once the lockdown is completed, shut every single power source in this station off. Every single one.
Okay. The VI appears. You can't really see it, but you can hear its voice saying, confirm, full lockdown and then full power down.
Yes.
And with that, you hear the sound of some machinery struggling. Some of these doors have not functioned for a very long time. Some of them don't work. You hear bits breaking off and smashing here and there. You hear some doors kind of closing. You hear some sort of bouncing off of each other as they attempt to lock down. And then shortly after that, there is suddenly just a as all lights and indeed all power in this place gets completely shut down.
Including all the spooky stuff?
Spooky stuff is still there.
Oh, damn it. Well, that's my turn anyway.
Beautiful turn, though. Talora or Miles, who would like to go?
I think Talora, right? Because I'm out of it.
Yeah. Okay, so Erdar still has the other one grappled? Is that it?
No, currently the Turian has just escaped Erda's grapple and is now making her way away from this place. Yeah.
But stealthed, so we have no idea where she is.
But also stealthed.
All right. Yeah. Talora would go for Miles and try and help him.
Okay. Would you like to do a medicine check on him to see if you can pull him out of this stupor he's in right now?
Yes. Yes, I will do that.
Let me just... what's your current health, Miles? You're above half. Great. So that's something with a difficulty of 2. I'm going to say that since there's smoke everywhere and you can't see anything, the concealment penalty will still apply. So I think this is actually the first roll we've made since you applied a bonus. So we'll say the bonus gets applied to you.
Yeah, okay.
Feel free to go whenever you're ready.
Well, that's a good roll. All right.
So not only do you manage to... did you already do a medicine check on Miles? Or...
Yes, isn't the...
To fix my leg earlier.
Right. Yeah. But did you do one after the explosion as well, or did you only do...
No.
Okay, cool. So Miles, you're still capable to receive first aid. So Miles, you heal for 3 wounds, and you get 1 strain back as well. You hear the nurturing and firm voice of Talora. It's weird because you're in this battlefield right now. You've been thrust back into a moment of your past, and you're so focused on like surviving the onslaught that is coming, like picking your targets and desperately trying to not get yourself killed during this contact between Turian and human forces. And then suddenly you just hear, like, echoing over the landscape, the voice of Talora. And it's this weird moment where just reality seems to break down and detach a little bit for you. And it allows you a little bit of a moment to sort of snap back to reality. You still have a terrible headache. There's still no sign of this entity, but you are cognizant of your surroundings.
All right, so I'll check to see if I again got shot in the face.
At this current time, you have not been shot in the face.
Well, that's very kind. Is everything still active, or...?
Yes.
Okay. I will... I'll take a second to like, gather myself, because this is all bizarre, and I know that the Turians are fake, but that they can still do damage. I'm going to try to safely still run in the direction that the Turian is, I'm guessing, running.
Okay, sounds great. Yeah, so, go ahead and do that. Effectively, your big obstacle here is you can't see, and there's some Turian fire coming your way. So let's just roll coordination to see how well you can get through it, or rather, how few holes you can get through you as you attempt this. So I'll say difficulty of this, and I'll just apply the concealment penalty again. Yeah. Go ahead and roll when you're ready. Coordination. Ooh.
Nope.
Unfortunately, as soon as you start running, you feel the impact of bullets into your shield, and you take the equivalent of a shot from them. So how much does your assault rifle do? Is it 4 damage? Is it 5 damage?
Mine is currently 5 because it's modified.
Then take...
In base form, it will do 4.
Got it. So go ahead and take 7 points of damage then.
7. Ouch.
Okay.
Hey, that's my maneuver.
All right.
To move forward.
You could potentially get another maneuver if you'd like. If you'd like to keep trying to push through.
I'll use my fitness power to get another maneuver.
Sounds good.
And then I'll be in like the location of where I'm assuming she might be, and then I'm going to take a guess at where she actually is and shoot.
Okay. Actually, with the amount you maneuver, I think that is just enough for you to get to the edge of the smoke, so you can just about see, well, not much, but at the very least, the smoke isn't a problem anymore. So yeah, you can take an educated guess and just try and fire. Let's go ahead.
Because she's trying to get to the exit. I know where the exit is.
Yeah. Path of least resistance and all that. Sounds great. So, this is going to be, let's see. This is going to be a... How should I do this? I think instead of normal range, we're just going to roll against her stealth? No, we're not going to do that. We're going to do normal range rolls, but she'll get a stealth roll. Do perception first, and we'll see how well you can pick her up. How about that?
Okay.
I'm going to give you one setback die, because there's a bit of smoke nearby, but you're out of the most of it. And then against her stealth skill, let me just double check what that is.
I should take levels in perception.
Yeah. 3, 4. Okay, got it. And go ahead and roll when you're ready.
A nice failure.
That actually wasn't the full roll, so please roll again. You might get lucky.
Okay.
Ooh.
Oopsie doodles.
Yeah, you open fire at what you assume she is. You slam, you know, into some ancient Perthian, very expensive tech, and it explodes, sending out some sparks in this place, but otherwise you do not think you got a solid impact there. And she has disappeared. However...
Yeah, too clever for me.
I'll say as well that the threat you generated, instead of doing anything to your weapons or yourself particularly, since your strain is a little bit low right now, basically you can see that the door to this place didn't fully close and is just enough for a single person to get through. And it is unclear to you whether she's gone through it yet, though. She could potentially still be hiding in the room you're in.
I'm thinking that because she wasn't where I thought she would mm-hmm. be, she's done something sneaky and not just run straight for the exit.
Right. Okay. New round. Is that everything, Miles?
That is all. All
right. It is at that point where the entity flashes in front of you, appears once again, it sort of disappears as it blinks back into the smoke, going back towards your companions. New round. The Turian is going to try and stealth away. So, Miles, let's do another perception versus stealth. And let's see how you do.
Assuming terribly.
One story point left if you'd like to use it.
No, that's good. I think I might still see her, but I'll have given up.
So, good news.
I have no idea.
You get one advantage to spend as you would like. Unfortunately.
Recover screen.
Basically, you hear a noise. And you assume that's her, and then realize, oh, she might have thrown something to get her, and at that point, she's completely lost from your visual.
Yeah, I have no idea.
But, at this point, you hear the sound of a decloaking. You just don't have eyes on it. She's in the next room. New PC turn. Who would like to go?
Is anybody else hurt?
Currently, you and Miles are the most hurt. Also, there are ghostly... Turians and humans shooting up the place all around you. So actually, Taloro, you're in the biggest danger. So Taloro, would you mind giving me a very quick... Actually, no, it's going to be an attack against you. Never mind. Make things nice and straightforward. Taloro... Oh, goodness! I'm so sorry. Taloro, you are suddenly blindsided as you are hit for 8 points of damage. As just... There are just bullets flying throughout this smoke. And one of them finds its way to you.
Alright...
And now it's your turn, Taloro.
Alright, is there a way that I can think of to turn them off?
You don't necessarily know how they are powered or how they function. You could try and think about how that is if all other power here has been turned off, if you would like.
Alright, but can I get to cover first?
Yes, you can definitely feel around, leave it as a cover, avoid all these Turians and humans who have appeared shooting each other.
Yeah, just hunker down so somewhere and like, how the fuck do I shut this down and why do they still have power?
Good news about these echoes is they're murdering each other, so that's one silver lining of the situation. Okay, so give me knowledge or mechanics to figure out how this thing functions.
Knowledge it is.
Oh boy, that's a success and a triumph. You are struck with a sudden epiphany, Taloro. You glanced, one of the brief notes that was sent to you by Kalor about all the research data here, informed you that the technology they were using for what they call Project Anamnesis had the green light for some of the Protheans' most advanced and very scarce technology. And as such, they managed to create a device of unprecedented power that could last for a very long time. You now firmly believe that that device is what the Turian was running away with. So basically, all these echoes, if they are indeed tied to this thing, your best guess is that they are tied to that particular thing that she's running off with. Oh, you're muted.
Are muted.
I know, my daughter was loud and I forgot. Can I use a story point to have Erdar follow the other one? Because she can probably deal with stealth the best. I mean, she's very
basically
good at
set
stealth.
Her on the Turian's tail?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Alright, and it's like, can I share what my epiphany, you know, can I share that with like everybody? that, you know, to shut this off, we gotta catch her and take the device away from her.
Yeah, you can definitely yell.
She's gone. It's too late.
Under lockdown, she can't escape.
Door's wide open.
It's really not. And that's only one door. There's a bunch of doors in this place. The next room's probably blocked off.
This is all happening, by the way, sorry to interrupt, but while there's still gunfire happening in the smoke between Turian and human echoes.
Can I still call upon the VI, or was that actually shut down too?
Unfortunately, that is gone.
Yep.
Power down.
How about we give Erda one more shot to get her or not, and then we'll go from there.
Sounds good. Someone else roll for Erda, because
sure.
I'm bad.
Yes. Please let Werewolf do it.
So, this is going to be Turian's stealth versus Erda's perception. Let me just make sure this is all good. I will spend a story point to make this a little bit harder. And anything else? There's no more smoke anymore, so it's just a matter of...
That was an accident.
Her natural concealment from the cloak. So you're not using that story point, is that right?
You know what, why not? Let's use it.
Okay. Go ahead and roll Erda's stealth. Oh no, perception when you're ready.
Good lord, Erda!
That's 5 failures, but 1 advantage. So she loses the Turian, but finds a trail. And I think that might be the note we end on for tonight, everybody. We can decide how this squad follows up on this Turian who is leaving, turning tail and running with this ancient powerful device next time. So if you would like to see the conclusion to this cat and mouse chase through a base that has been completely shut down, powered down, and locked down, well, you just have to join us next week. Huge thank you to my wonderful players for joining us. If you would like to go around and say anything you would like to say, please feel free to. Let's start with Paladin.
Oh, that's me. Hi. Hi, everybody. I'm Paladin Hulk, Twitch moderator for Random Tuesday and Little Red Dot. And this was fun. Gosh, this game is so stressful at times. Everything is just exploding and action-packed all the time. Whew. Okay, where can you find me next? Let's see. It's tomorrow on Uncanny Adventures, where I play Holt, the pirate paladin who tries to make friends with all the evil pirates. We're playing again after a bit of downtime. So I'm looking forward to it, and we might be using captions for the first time.
Woohoo!
Tune in. And then Tuesday, I'm back on Potter Scripted's channel with Thomas and our absent Forta as we go back to the Wandering Menagerie. If you want a fun one-shot, last week Polish was unavailable, so we did a fun little thing where Flip was GMing.
Played
a totally awesome werebeaver that you should totally check out.
What was his name, Paladin?
Chad Beaverton. Because that's the coolest name I could figure for this guy. Yeah. And then Friday, I have the finale of my game on Raven's channel, the Black Feather Guild. It's Beyond the Wall. We've been exploring the dream world for a long time, just trying to separate them out from reality again. And we've just returned to reality after some terrible failures at fixing each other's trauma. So, whoops. But we're here, and we're going to try to save the world one last time.
Beautiful.
And I play Tom Fan, your friendly ghost there. Yeah.
And Vivi, anything you would like to plug?
Well, tonight I'm at 9 o'clock. I am playing on Stella Luna's channel. She's doing one of her marathons, actually, where she's doing 3 brand new systems. And I know that in the middle they're playing Tidewater, but I'm going to play Valor, where we're basically like kind of cool, like anime like infiltrators. So that's going to be interesting because we've never played this before. And you have to make like your own move, like from a shopping list. So 9 p.m. EST on Stella Luna's channel today. On Monday, I am back on Wily Hobbit's channel to play our D&D game in the Dalelands. We're playing in the Grendelroot from Sly Flourish right now. That's my baby artificer. And then in 2 weeks, Wednesday, we're going to be streaming our first part of the ultra modern D&D game we're going to be playing. And yeah, I don't really know much about it yet. I'll let you know next time.
Beautiful. And Werewolf.
Hi, my name is Norden Lee, or Werewolf Feels. You can check me online to see what I'm doing. But the next big things are a new episode of Missing Annie Lee, a podcast that I'm in just dropped. We're more than halfway through, so if you want to catch up, now's a great time. You can catch me playing in an Expanse game called Churn and Burn on Valdrian's channel every Thursday. We're again wrapping up. We're going to the moon next, to my character Cyrus Faez's home city of Lovell, which is going to be really cool. And we're going to finally meet his mother, which is exciting, because his mother is a very important character. And I am really proud to announce that I'll be joining Gehenna Gaming for the next Monster Heart stream on Mondays, Gehenna Academy. So I'll be playing a ghost, and that is all I can reveal at this point. But I've got, there's a great cast of all POC folks. We're really excited for it, and hopefully I'll catch you there. May the 3rd is our premiere date.
Beautiful. And myself, we have Is This an Education? Our City of Mist Gonzo game happening tomorrow, Chromatic Chimera, at 1 p.m. Eastern time, I think. So check that out. It's a lot of fun. We missed last episode, so I'm excited to get back into it. Also, Wandering Menagerie on Polished Cryptids channel. Go ahead and check out myself, Paladin Forte, there if you would like. And finally, our music was by Stellar Drone from the album Light Years. That can be found on Free Music Archive under the license CC BY. That's all I have. Thank you all so much for joining us, and tune in next time, because I'm very excited to see how our squad continues from here. Should be very exciting. So again, thank you. We'll see you next time. Bye!